we can start. Welcome everyone from a closer proximity and a faraway proximity. It's very nice to have you all here. I think this might work as a very small working group. I hope we're going to have great discussions and very good outcomes our methodologies are. I think everyone knows everybody, basically. I would like to ask Professor Ioan-Marius Bucur. He is a friend of ours. We used to work together in the Cluj-Napoca project, where project is based, in fact. He is now deputy dean at our faculty and he is responsible with research at the faculty, and I think he is in the committee at the university with the committee on about research at the university. So if you would like to say a few words for us, and then we will proceed.
All right. Thank you, Lavinia. First of all, good morning, everyone. And on behalf of the Dean of the Faculty, I would like to welcome all the participants in this workshop organized by our college from the Institute of Oral History. Many of you know, one of the historical debates nowadays in Romania is about the demythologization of the many nations' narratives. Thus, I will appeal to one of the foundational rocks of this project, the partnership with our friends and colleagues from ASEAN, which was put into practice thanks to a magical intervention, if I may call it, that of a mythical figure, the historian used Cleo. Actually, it's about our collaboration in CleoNet and later in CleoRes European projects, which just borrowed the name from the above-mentioned dispute news. In fact, these two projects created long-term solid mutual knowledge among senior and young researchers across Europe, and we can see here one of its outcomes. On this base, working together on such relevant issues as the Roma history by bridging different cultural background and historical and anthropological tradition, it's obviously, I think, beneficial for all people involved. Anyway, I hope at the end of this today that all of us will be smarter, wiser, because older we will get anyway. Thank you, and let's hope that we'll have interesting discussion in these 2 days.
Well, I'm very glad to be here once again. This is my fourth or fifth or sixth time in Cluj. I lost my count. Lavinia and I, we were in Bucharest late last year, it was in
December 10th.
Yeah, and where all the EEA projects were introduced. I must say that our project was clearly the best.
Which
had more to do with Lavinia than me, I must admit, because we have been working very hard on interviews, and I think basically that we are on schedule and even beyond schedule in our work. So I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very interested to listen to your talks and presentations today and tomorrow, because I think we are in a very critical moment of the project. We are approaching the end. That's a rather scary thought. We have just over one year left, and we have been moving quite rapidly ahead. But we need, of course, to begin to think about how to use some material, the great material that you have been gathering in the interview. So it will be very interesting to to follow the discussions today and tomorrow, and then we should, at the end of these discussions, be able to see where to complete and wrap up our research. I don't think I have much more to say. I must admit that I am not totally awake. It was a very long day yesterday, and so I hope I won't be sleeping here and try to stay awake. So thank you for all the planning here.
I must publicly confess that I forgot to send the final agenda to everyone. I apologize for that. Thank you, for your introduction. I would like to say Professor Doro Radosav is sending his welcome. He said he might be here, if not having some administration at the University Library, where he is director now. Meetings there. So anyway, he is supporting our activities, and usually he is very much involved in what we are doing. Okay, so we could already move to our first panel, chaired by Professor Hagnarsson, and the first presenter is.
Okay, so it's already 10 o'clock, so we move, time moves. So we will start our first panel, and the first speaker this morning is Ionela Bogdan, and she's actually a doctoral student at the University of Iceland, and it's a kind of part of our partnership. Ionela is going to speak on the project, and the name of the talk is "Talk is Not Cheap: Tackling Women's Issues in Roma Communities."
Okay, so hello, good morning. Thank you very much to all for coming. And my presentation, "Talk is Not Cheap: Tackling Women's Issues in Roma Communities." So let's talk a little bit about the idea of that. Let's talk a little bit about the idea of the title. It came to me last week when my mother, I was having a little housing situation, and my mother told me it's always easier for me to talk than do something. Obviously, I convinced her by talking that she's wrong. So I'd like to talk about the phrase "talk is cheap," which you all know it means that it's, yes, easier to talk about something than actually doing it. So I think in correlation to oral history, talk is not cheap. Myself, as an oral historian in the making, I believe that talking is the main instrument in order to conduct a research. So basically, without talking, we would have no oral history. Okay, so this is something that remained in my mind, and Oki said it, that interviewing is rather like marriage. Everybody knows what it is, and an awful lot of people do it, and yet behind each closed door there is a world of secrets. Well, basically that is true. We tried and we succeed to enter into several Roma communities during this summer and last year. So I would like to talk to you a bit about my methodological issues that I encountered during this period. So, the thing is, I'm a PhD student, so I'm conducting a research about the manner in which gender and gender-designated roles developed during the communist regime among Roma communities in Transylvania, and probably in Romania, given the fact that I have so many interesting interviews in other parts of the country than Transylvania, which are, well, would be suitable for my research. Okay, so the decree 770, probably all of you know about it. I always tackle it during my interviews because it regards abortion and the prohibition of abortion and contraceptives. Basically, the picture is what the decree says in Romanian, I translated the decree more or less. So basically, the decree prohibited abortion except if so the pregnancy endangered the life of the woman and no other means could be taken, a hereditary disease was involved, the pregnancy was result of rape, or the woman was 45 years of age or over, she had already delivered and reared 4 children. Also, you have to know that during the communist regime, many new arrangements were made to this decree, so basically it became harder and harder for women to undergo an abortion in the legal manner. So obviously during my interviews I tried to talk about this issue, the manner in which women related to this decree. It's very sensitive to ask a woman you just met if she underwent an abortion, obviously. So after having the bravery of asking this, I'm always like, I hope she won't get upset and she would tell me something that I can use in my research. So, okay, moving forward. Other sensitive issues discussed among my interviews. So domestic violence is one of the main issues that appeared in my interviews. I never specifically asked about domestic violence, but usually women, after talking for a while about their life, they tell me if they underwent and if they were victims of domestic violence or domestic abuse during their lifetime. Okay, early marriages, this is a topic that I specifically ask, especially when I conduct research among the traditional Roma communities. Bride kidnapping, the same, because women tend to have the tendency of telling us that girls are not sent to school because there is this danger of them being kidnapped by, I don't know, a possible husband to be, and it's very difficult after that to get the girl back. So basically, after the girl is kidnapped, she remains in the family of the kidnapper. So I specifically asked about this, and I have a very interesting interview of a woman in Nokriš, in Sibiu County, who told me about how she was kidnapped by her cousin and a friend of her cousin. They told her to go to the shop, and after that they took the girl in another county. She managed to escape, and after that she managed to... The thing is, they wanted her to marry a boy who was very young. He was, I think, 8 or 9 years old, and she was much older than that. And for her it was difficult to accept this situation. Okay, so after that she told me she was able to remarry without having any problems and without her being stigmatized because she was kidnapped. Okay, women also told me about their childhood dramas. I have an interview from Timiș County in the village of Măgur. It's a collective interview, actually, and the thing is, these women, we started having a cup of coffee and chit-chatting, basically. And slightly, one of the women started telling me how hard it was for her when growing up, because she had a very strict mother, and she always wanted to please her mother, but it seemed impossible to do so. So, she tells me how she got pregnant at an early age, and her mother found out about it. And her mother was very upset. She decided to go with the daughter to the doctor and undergo an abortion, which the girl didn't want because she wasn't sure if the father of the child wouldn't marry her afterwards, and it would have been no problem in raising the child and so and so. Okay, so she tells me that when they arrived to the doctor, her mother told the doctor she was raped, and that's the reason why they want to terminate the pregnancy, which was not true because the girl wasn't raped. So she is telling me how hard it was for her to say to the doctor, yes, it's true, I was raped, even though she knew she wasn't raped, and because she wanted to please her mother. Okay, this is one of the childhood dramas that I was told about. I have many other stories, but I think it's not the time now. So, I have nothing to say. What do you want me to say? These are common beginnings for many of my interviews, probably not only my interviews, my colleagues also. The thing is, sometimes people believe that their story is not important, or that you believe their story is not important, so they don't really want to tell you their life story, and after that to hear from you as the researcher that, well, that wasn't something I wanted to hear, or can you tell me about something else, because obviously their life story is important and is unique because it's their own. So, I have to say that many times when I heard these phrases, the interview proved to be quite good and people had stuff to talk about, and I managed to conduct very good interviews. But we have to take into consideration that sometimes private life remains private, and it would be disrespectful from us to try to make them talk about something that they don't wish to talk about. So I think this is, so I will proceed to the ethical issues. I think what I said before can be an ethical issue, because there is an equal relationship between interviewer and narrator, because we have this type of authority when we go into the community, and we are with the recorder or with the camera, and we want them to tell us everything. So most of the times we asked from our narrators to tell us stories that often come only from intimate relationships, and it's difficult for them to open up all of a sudden. So it's important to try to understand the narrator, and if he or she doesn't want to talk about a specific issue, to just let it go. Okay, also regarding the publication of potential harmful information for the narrator, so I wrote an article for the IO issue, and I sent it to Professor Ludmundur to give me his feedback, and thankfully he gave me his feedback, and he told me, well, what type of modality do you try to protect your interviewers, your interviewees? And well, I knew he was referring to a specific interview that I mentioned in the article about a woman who underwent, she performed on herself an illegal abortion. She gave birth to the stillborn baby, and because she was afraid to not get arrested, she decided to bury the body of the fetus in her garden. So the thing is, the woman told me she doesn't want to remain anonymous. It's okay for her to, if I use her name. But at first I used her name, and Professor Gunmundur said, well, yes, but this is a very delicate issue. You have to take into consideration that it can harm the narrator. So I decided to, even though she didn't want to remain anonymous, I decided to use another name, to use a pseudonym, in order to protect her. Because, well, as Alessandro Portelli often said in his article, it is important for the interviewer to have a better judgment on the issue and to understand when the facts that are being told can harm the interviewee, and try not to harm him or her. Okay, so also this would be my main concern: how do we explain the lives of others without violating their reality? So when someone tells you her life story or his life story, obviously you try to interpret what you hear from that person, but you never are 100% sure that what you interpreted was correct, or if you didn't upset them in one way or another. So probably for me this would be my main ethical issue, because I would never want to publish an article that is well received or is not well received, it doesn't matter, but the narrator in my interview and from my article to be harmed in some way. Okay, so probably I would like to get some feedback from you regarding this issue, because some of you have more experience than me and I would love to hear your input on the matter. Okay, so now I will leave you with, I don't have any conclusions because it's hard to get conclusions, it's still early, I guess, and every Roma woman I talked to is different, and we can't say that there is a Roma community, there are Roma communities, and they are very different and unique in their own way, and we shouldn't make general assessments regarding the Roma communities. Okay, so this is one of my favorite photos, it's from Magur village in Timiș County. I still keep in touch with one of the women there. She called me before Christmas to tell me she is having an argument with one of her neighbors because she wanted to know if Brasov is a county or not. And well, I said, yes, Brasov is a county. And she said, okay, so are you sure? Did you check that internet of yours? And I said, yes, I checked the internet and Brasov is a county. And she said, okay, I will tell my neighbor that you told me so, but that you checked the internet, so you're pretty sure about it. Okay, so basically, Tanti Jeta, how I call her, was so nice to me. We arrived in Magur and we basically didn't have anyone to talk to. Well, I didn't have anyone to talk to. Nick was already conducting an interview and Sanziana was searching for people to conduct interviews. And I was like just wandering around. And this lady was in the middle of the street. She was looking to see what type of people are there and stuff like that. And she said, why don't you come and sit with me and let's talk about different things. And well, we talked and talked because I had two interviews with her. This is a group interview I had in one of her relatives' house. And she basically, after the interview, she fed me a lot. And after that she told me you should come another day and we will talk again and I will give you again to eat, because she needs to eat. This is the thing, they are so, I met very, very friendly people. Basically they all wanted to give us something to eat or to drink. We were so well received, so this is beyond words. Okay, so another photo. This is Jova, another person that I keep in touch with. She is my first, she is part of the cultural community, cultural Căldărar. She is from Merdindial, Sibiu County, and she is the first woman I talked to, which is from a traditional community. And I started the interview and she said, well, you basically have no clue what to ask about our community, do you? And I was like, well, it's a bit difficult for me to ask specific things because I don't really know your community. And she was like, okay, so you need this interview for school? And I said, yes, I'm doing a PhD thesis. And she said, well, okay, I will tell you what you need to know and I will tell you what you should ask after that. We still keep in touch. We were actually invited to her son's wedding. The son is in the photo also, Nonu. So probably he will marry after Easter in May, and we were invited to the wedding. Obviously, we will go. And we still keep in touch. As I was saying, they called me for Christmas and they sang carols to me in the Romani language. They are very, very nice people. And Jova makes the best schnitzele. You all know what schnitzele is. Okay, so this is another woman I managed to have a very nice conversation in Ibișuvei, also Sibiu County. Her name is Maria. The friends and relatives call her Marica. And she was very keen in talking to me because she already had different people coming into her house and asked her things about her life. She participated also at some sort of a play in a school where she
talked about the traditions of the Corturari. That's her son. Her name is Traian. She was very happy to have a son because among Corturari communities, they basically need a son in order to keep the family name and the ancestry going. And she told me they named the boy Traian after our former president, Traian Băsescu, and because he's blonde and he's so cute. And the doctors, when they saw the child, they said, oh, Traian, you should name him Traian, which they did. Okay. So, this is another, she is from the Gabor community, this lady. She is almost 19 years old, is from Tirimia, Mureș County, but as you see, she doesn't really wear the traditional clothing because she told me, well, she's old enough, she doesn't need to tell people she's a Gabor woman because they should know already. She also told me regarding the mixing marriages. She told me that for her it's not a problem and that she would accept if someone, a Roma, would marry a Romanian or a Hungarian or whatever, that in her opinion this is not important. And actually in the back of the picture is her granddaughter, yes, and she had a new baby with a Romanian. And also the granddaughter doesn't preserve the tradition anymore. She always wears pants among in the community and apparently it's not a problem. They are not perceived as being less Gabor than other Gabor. But also in Tirimia live a few Gabori and Crăciunești is the main village where the Gabor live and they do preserve the tradition. Okay, so I have one more picture. Probably Diana has it also in her presentation, but I had to put it also. This is us among our first field trip in Sibiu County, in Medindial. It's Diana and me among the Corturari women, which they were so happy to talk to us and we were so happy to be well received. So, thank you for listening to me. This would be all. And please, if you have any feedback for me, feel free to say it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ionela. Questions? Comments?
You forgot to mention that in Măgur we all almost lost you because they want to make you a daughter-in-law, so Ionela was really well affected by the community there. I wanted to raise this discussion about the ethics of doing oral history research. Basically, we had some ideas on how to do this, but when we got on the fieldwork, we discovered a lot of challenges that had to be dealt with. For example, something that is very important is that we have consent for all of our interviewees. So we have a piece of paper in which they say they agree that we use the interview in scientific purposes. And they have the opportunity of choosing to be anonymous or to keep their name. So this was basically the ground, the ethical ground for us doing research and using their information about their life. Three weeks ago, there was this young researcher who came at the Oral History Institute, and he said he is doing the research on how the universities in Romania are dealing with ethical issues. So we had a very interesting discussion about how we are dealing with ethical issues in our work. And there were lots of questions that were raised during that conversation. And I know now that we definitely, and after Ionela's discussion with Professor Hartmann about the fact that in her paper there was a name, because the lady had no problem in letting her using the name, but she was speaking about something that the criminal law might stand against her. And that was the moment we have realized that there might be in our interviews stuff told by the people that might harm them. So we are thinking of doing a list of ethical aspects that we have encountered during our research in order to make sure we can check them and make sure that the information and the life of people we are talking with is protected, and we are responsible for not using one way. So this is something which I think we have to consider more and pay more attention during our research than we used to do before starting the project. Of course, the topics we've done before were not so intimate sometimes. Now there are situations in which people really speak about their intimate life, and Colleen reminded me about an interview in which one person speaks about how his brother disciplined his son by beating him. And in few days or in time, the son died. So these are really, really sensitive issues.
Yeah, but the son committed suicide.
Yeah.
He did not die of the beating, but I don't know.
Committed suicide, I don't know. So.
I'm not a historian, but there seems to be a kind of different approach between anthropology and oral history in dealing with names. I mean, anthropology, I don't think you ever use names, because, and I think it's a kind of approach. I think historians are more interested in the kind of individuals and to place them into kind of correct situation, while in anthropology you are more interested in the situation and the names do not matter. I mean, it doesn't really. You have the name, and you have the names registered, and so it's clear who the person is. But when you are analyzing the material, the name doesn't really make any difference. I mean, it's not interesting. It's really the situation you're interested in. So my kind of. I mean, but I have also seen this in there's another PhD student, I was in her committee, and she was doing research on Danes in Iceland, and they were using names, and I thought that was very strange, because if you use names, people begin immediately, at least in Iceland, which is a very small country, to try to place the people, who are they, I mean, where are they, and, I think it's a kind of a distraction from what is really important is what you are really studying. It's not the person, not the person as such, but their situation, their context, their. I think this is something that needs to be discussed. But maybe there are simply different traditions in oral history than there are in Iceland.
That's true, because the father of the oral history. The important people that create oral history are focusing on the importance of the person. And we have encountered during our research people that are speaking, you should put me on the cover of your book. I am important, my story is important. So these are situations in which the interviewees themselves are in a way getting importance, or their self-identity is emphasized because of our action of going and interviewing them. So yes, I think it's different, and because of that sometimes it's important to mention the names and sometimes not. I mean, in different situations. But that is the point of kind of suggesting and talking about when it's important to, for example, when we were in Strehaya, at Leodela Strehaya's, in the Leodela Strehaya's community, this is a very famous Manele singer who is pretty famous in Romania, and the entire neighborhood related to this guy, and they wanted in a way to be more famous than the guy that was at the television. So they kept, well, you should come back to us. We will organize for you a fireplace, and but you should put us in your book. And this is a good picture for the cover of your book. You see, there are different way of. But I would, before doing this, I would never think it could be an issue, and it is an issue.
And there is another situation when the interviewee wants to remain anonymous for what he said, but we have photos with him. He agreed to be photographed. So do we use those photos, or how to handle the situation? So we have this problem when organizing the photo gallery. You see tomorrow.
Well, basically, when the person wants to preserve his or her anonymity, we decide not to use the picture because, for example, for our photo exhibition, we had a very good picture with someone who wanted to be anonymous. So that's a pity, but we won't use the picture, obviously. But also, you have to know that these people, even if they want to be anonymous in the interview, they want to take their picture with their house and stuff like that. So it's a bit difficult because probably they don't want to be anonymous, but they do want to be anonymous if they tell us delicate issues. So we should take into account this.
Yeah, I also wanted to say that it might be a difference between the ethical issues in anthropology and in the oral history, and about informed consent, for example. That informed consent would imply that we know what we are doing with those data we are collecting. But in anthropology, you usually don't have a strong hypothesis. Mm-hmm. So you tell the people you are doing the research, but it's not quite so much. You are not yourself in a position to say what is will be the end product. So then it's always an issue of agreeing, and also the possibility to withdraw from the consent. So that if you don't want to be part, then later I'm coming back, and you can still, before I publish, you can say that you don't want to be part of it. So it is more flexibility and also more awareness, because you have to protect your informant, but also there is a responsibility of the supervisor to protect the students who is doing this, because, for example, there was a large debate recently in an American case about Alice Goffman. She is a sociologist, actually, doing qualitative research in ghetto communities, and she describes in her thesis, and the thesis was published also as a book, how his main key informant was killed, and he was very angry, and he went with gang members around in her car, and watching and seeking for those who killed his key informant, and this is in the book. So then it, a lot of questions arise, that why the supervisor let her to write about a criminal conspiracy, which is under criminal law, of course, she can be persecuted. So, at the one hand, we have to protect the informant, we have to protect our students as well. So that is a responsibility for somebody doing this kind of research in anthropology. I'm not sure about oral history, if you can encounter such situations. It depends, of course, how you collect your data or what you do. But indeed, when you see and you record information which might come under the criminal law, and you don't report then you might be in a position that you have to destroy all those information and not to publish, of course, that is, or if not destroy, but anonymize and then use it somehow transform. In anthropology, we have all kinds of techniques what we do. For example, you can take apart a person and do it situational, like describe the situation, but not in one life course. Or you can use narrative techniques to hide the place where it happened and things like that. And indeed, I'm curious about oral history, but why they are interested in the person. So, is the person as a, because usually if you do factual history, you have more reliable sources than personal memory.
No, that's very debatable. I'm gonna speak about how reliable the written sources are in comparison with oral history. I mean, we need to have definitely the same critical approach to both.
Right.
It's not such a big difference. So it's important because this is the point of doing oral history. Until doing oral history, you would have only official history or master narrative history. And then all these people in the, basically started earlier, but in the 60s and 70s, started to emphasize the importance of everyone's history and how important is everyone's memory and the story about memory and so on. And in this context, it emerged the idea that everyone has own history, and then it has to have a name attached to this. Of course, for example, when we are not doing only oral history, we have Manuela, and I think all of us went in the archives, and we are collecting written documents about the Roma. But I think it is essential, and there are parts, for example, in Romanian case, and I'm anticipating a bit the discussion I wanted to have in my presentation. In Romania, when we speak about the communist past, we have either documents produced by the authority, which has us, I mean, we need to look at them with a certain critical perspective, and that's the Genesis, the document from the former archive, but not only. And we have, on the other hand, some oral history testimonies with the non-Roma. And there are some topics that generally are visible in these non-Roma interviews. On the other hand, after we've done several interviews, we discovered that there are areas of the Romanian communist past that are not covered by none of this. For example, the way impact a certain legislation had on Roma people. For example, there was a law, it was such as the law presented by Ionela, it was a law that applied to everyone, but in fact it affected massively Roma communities. And it was a law number 153 in 1970, and there were the law against who forbid people to sacrifice any animal at home. The Roma were massively, many, if not almost all narratives, they mention this, the way they had to manage to avoid. It is a very complicated issue. For example, the communist regime invented something which was a combination, you know, the distinction, basic distinction in legislation between criminal and contraventional. Contravention is when you pay a fine because you parked wrongly, and the criminal is when you do crime or something. But the communist regime invented something which was called contraventional prison. For small just passing of the law, people would be put in prison for several days. And this happened to many Roma. This law 153 was about it was about a lot of stuff, but it was against those who tended to have a parasitic lifestyle. And it was a golden legislation for the authorities in order to, and we have stories of abuses, a lot of abuses. So these are part that our understanding of communist regime is not as complete as possible, because we didn't have these stories and now we have these stories. So because of that, it's so important to have, again, it's not so important to have names when I'm speaking about this phenomenon, but when we go closer to everyone's life story, it's amazing. For example, Kalin is now working on a collection of interviews with mainly men, I think, in the Gabor community in Cluj-Napoca. They have amazing life stories, extremely coherent, with lot of hint of how everyday life of the community was possible during communism. And this is essential for the understanding of the entire totalitarian regime. I mean, I don't know, I think I'm far away from the...
Sofiya?
I just wanted to say, I remember, this is about the renaming of, I remember Anne Dolan when she was giving the talk on writing her book and working with the American gatherers, how disappointed were her informants, the main family she worked with, when they saw her book and they saw their names renamed. And they were like, why are we doing it? So it's, when you put someone on focus, so to say, it's a way, my life is important, I want to be...
And if it's positive, I think, and if it's positive, it's, you have something to criticize, then probably they might be offended if you do that.
It's just something, I'm ethnographer, so in the Bulgarian ethnographic tradition, so to say, since the 19th century on, you just go, you record the person, it's this grandma in this village, this age, with this name, and then you have to archive this data in order to be able to use it in your publication. Of course, in your publication, you may just prefer not to use the name, but to put the age like a typical grandma from this village or typical widow and so on. So we never had this issues, but of course about the ethical issues with when something is criminal, like the early marriages, or drug abuse, drug production, drug distribution.
Yes,
we really
also had an interview like that. So,
these are, and you really have to be very careful, because when I was researching, it was the early marriages in one community in northeastern Bulgaria. So one of the big income activity there is calling Turkish, because they're Turkish speakers, so they the women become in contact with Turkish citizens and they say, I want to marry you, stuff like this, send me money, I have to get rid of my parents here, they treat me badly and so on. But actually these are not unmarried women, these are women that are with families, and actually this is the income generating activity of this and everyone knows about it, so I never had doubts should I report it. And actually it says more about the state and the institutions than about the Roma. So I really think we have to be very careful, but of course when it's about heavy violence, that traffic of people, and when somebody is endangered, and the boy who killed himself, it's really a very very sensitive issues, and I myself am not sure in what positions as a person and as a citizen, totally not as a researcher, what would be my position. And also regarding the early marriages, because I've been recently researching that. I think it's very important to not to stand on the point of the human rights approach only when it's as a citizen, but also to see the community point of view and regard what is their community point of view, because in some communities that I've been researching, an early marriage may occur even before puberty, but they just take the daughter-in-law and they educate her in the family customs and so on, so it's not a total criminal activity also. But really main issues arise on these issues. And regarding the early marriage, I was wondering about this kidnapping narrative, because in Bulgaria there was indeed in the past the kidnapping or elopement type of marriage, but it was almost always agreement between the two parts, so the kidnapping was rather an imitation. And in the last 15 years maybe, there were very few cases of kidnapping, but always in the narratives of the people you meet the kidnapping narrative, or we stop her from going to school, or we don't want to go to school in the nearby town because she could be kidnapped. Yeah. But there are no kidnapping cases in the community since more than 20 years. You know, they legitimize this by saying that she might be kidnapped, but a kidnapping never happens to the girls at all.
So is it the situation? Yeah. Basically, the situation is the same among Roma communities we conducted interviews in. When I asked, so when was the last time a girl was kidnapped from your community? They would say, well, we don't remember that, but this phenomenon is always happening, and it's a constant in our community, but they can't give specific cases. So this case, yeah, probably, so I mean, even if the bride didn't want to marry the boy she was kidnapped by, probably some of her relatives wanted the wedding to take place, and that's why the kidnapping took place eventually. So, obviously, the girl told me, well, I didn't want to marry him, so obviously, after he took me, I tried to do my best in order to escape, because I didn't want to marry an 8-year-old boy, given the fact that she was 15. So,
And also something about the combination between archival and oral history, or interviews, personal interviews, particularly in the communist period in Bulgaria. If you look only at the documents, there was renaming of Roma with Turkish names and with Muslim religion, so there was this renaming to have Bulgarian names, to become non-Muslims, to stop doing the customs. And in one document from the state security, you read that there was a big demonstration of Roma people in front of the party house in Sofia, which never happened. But this is something about the state security paranoia. So they say there were hundreds of people gathering there, stuff like this. And if you read only the document, you should say there was a demonstration in the center of Sofia against this. But if you interview all the people that are said to be there, people from the biggest community in Sofia, no one remembers such a thing, and such thing actually never happened, because it was not reported in media. So it was only these state security guys who just figured out something. And if you only read the documents without sticking it with other information, it's also so it's really important also to combine both.
Mm.
Yeah, that was
one. Oh, yes. Stressing the point about using real names and why historians like to use real names is by using them, you are sort of not undermining the subjectivity of the individual. You're sort of portraying that there are ordinary individuals out there that have names, and they should be a part of history just as the people are the famous. So it becomes important to show this and show that ordinary people, women, for instance, that have traditionally been left out of historical texts, have names, and they are subjects of history, and they are agents of their own history.
The irony is that most of the names are only official names, because people use nicknames among themselves, and they never, those names are just on the papers, that nobody knows by those names probably, so you can use them, for not a major objection, just a criticism.
I mean, it's a question of if you imagine yourself being interviewed by Manuela, and just my own kind of gut feeling about my own life is that my own life is private. I don't want to expose it to the world. Although I'm perfectly happy speaking about it in kind of scientific terms, and so I think it's also a question of the kind of boundaries between yourself and the public and private. I think these boundaries are being massively invaded now with all these kind of Facebook and things that people are presenting themselves to the world openly. So I think this is maybe just a retrograde conservatism on my part, but it's a. So in a sense I myself at least would like to keep my private life private, and I would imagine that many other people are think the same. I mean, they would be willing to discuss these things in a more abstract way, but not in a more personal way. So I think we just need to be aware of these things, and we need to always understand them, how the mechanisms are. And I also, if you would do an interview, go into a people's home, and I think people respond differently. Even if you say, I mean, I'm perfectly fine using my name, maybe they're not saying the same things as they would be saying if you would say, I speak behind the kind of a curtain of anonymity. So I don't know. I mean, it's something that we need to be aware of. I don't think it's only a question of ethics. I think it's also a question of the narrative itself. I mean, what do you say? What do you say to a stranger who comes into your house? I think you say different things if you're speaking to the world, or you're simply just speaking, presenting a case where you are. You're just a case, you're not a person, I think you're saying different things. But as I say, it seems that there are different traditions in these approaches to research. So I did not encounter this for the first time in your article. I've already encountered it in another oral history project, as I said before. And there, the person that we're doing interview, they all find the name, so okay. And so, but I just thought it was a little bit off.
Last comment. When I published an article in collective room at a German public house, they specifically asked me for the copyright for the quotation I took from the interview. So I had to have, I mean, without the signed consent, I couldn't do that, I couldn't provide anything. So this might be another problem when going and publishing. I mean, of course, we can rephrase what people said, and then we don't, we can. We have to put a reference to that, but I don't know how the publishing house will deal with this copyright material. But if we put quotation, some publishing houses ask for the right of using that. So this might be another issue. It's not related to the usage of name or mine, but to have some consent. So this.
it's the same for the images. So you have to have release form from
yeah, well, I didn't have it wasn't some
the face is recognizable, so then the person should agree.
Okay, these are extremely interesting issues and basic issues in research that we are discussing, not only the Roma research, but all research that are using people as subjects and living people as subjects of their narratives. Because, I mean, we are dissecting people's lives. We are interpreting what people are thinking and saying. So it matters how we do it. Okay, if there are not any other questions, I think we're now for the presentation. And next on the agenda is Sofiya Zahova, and she is going to speak about approaches and challenges in researching Romani literature. Sorry.
Thank you. Thanks to the project for inviting me, and I think really these smaller formats are very more fruitful for discussions and as opposed to big conference events, and I'm really glad that we started such a discussion. I think that I already had the chance to speak about the topic of Romani literature in front of some of you, so excuse me for repeating myself, but my plan is to first make a really very, very short overview of what I suggest to be viewed as a Romani literature, and then the second part of the presentation will be devoted to the approaches and challenges and as I see them and as I was thinking of them. In my reflections on Romani literature. And I adopt a kind of a broader definition of Romani literature, referred to the written word of literature created by and for Roma, meaning that it might be in different languages. As I will be back to this, to the periodization later, but as in many other European languages, the first text to appear in Romani language were the biblical translation or translations of parts of the Bible, and even until today we have publications in different dialects. These are the examples of translations from Bulgarian, one of the Bulgarian dialects. And in my publications on Romani literature, I've suggested a kind of periodization in the development, starting with the first, the pioneering works of written corpus here and there, and these were the biblical, the translations of the Bible that were done in Spain, for example, and in Bulgaria, and this was the English Bible Society from that time active in these areas. But for, let's say, more literature approach was developed in the Soviet Union as part of the state's policies of codification of the languages of the different nationalities. It was a short period, but quite productive, so there was lots of propaganda literature in a kind of standardized Romani language, and also poetry works, textbooks translated into Romani with Cyrillic script. And then in the interwar period in the Balkan countries and I think in some Central European countries there were also publications within the newspapers of Romani organizations, more political activities with some text in Romani but primarily in the national languages. And since in the second half of the 20th century, we have a kind of national development here and there. Sometimes in some countries nothing appeared, but in others there were publications by Roma authors. And there are like two types of developments. One type is the Bulgarian, for example, that the ethno-national state was had such an ideology that was promoting the development of a Bulgarian nation, and there were no nationalities and ethnic groups and minorities that could develop their culture. So the Roma authors creating in this time were part of the national canon, so to say. So they were creating in Bulgarian language with a kind of marginalization of the Roman identity, though the Roma community were like part of their poems, for example. Another type of policies were that of the federative states, and particularly, for example, Yugoslavia, again as part of the national policies for development of the nationalities and the ethnic groups. They were kind of supporting of the production in Romani language, including literature. And then in the 70s and 80s, there was this the internationalization of the Romani issues and Romani activism in Europe, cross-border activities, some international activities were giving the rise of the Roma issues also in national level. So we have, for example, a couple of publications with growing number of publications in the German-speaking countries about the memories about the Holocaust. In other countries also publications like folklore, poetry production, also periodicals. And the boom of Romani literature, so to say, since the 80s, and particularly after the changes in the 90s, growing number of production of Romani literature in all countries, of course with particularities in Southeastern Europe. As I said, there is this repeating of this Herderian, so to say, model of a growing corpus of folk literature, like folk tales, author's tales based on folklore, folklore song, but also poetry song, and also a growing number of memoir literature in all countries. And of course, I claim that and I think in contemporary literature as a whole, it's very hard to speak about pure literature, so to say. So if we think about the last Nobel Prize winner, she's actually was collecting the stories of the people. And actually, if we look at Romani literature pieces from contemporary world, what we see, I will give this to the audience. So this is a comics. This is the English language edition. A comics book made in Sweden, in Kaltarash and Swedish and Swedish language for the first time, narrating about a girl who survived the Holocaust. And this is a comics in which you see actually the story of the girl, but you see the historical event and also the Romani community, so to say, reactions, including some humor in these situations. Again, an audiobook from Sweden with lots of pictures, and actually this book incorporates the life story of a girl, of a Romani girl in Sweden, with some grand narratives, so to say, of the Romani movement, like the origins from India, the Holocaust as a history of the Romani people, and so on. And Luminita Cioba, actually, she also collected some information about, in the last decade, she's active in collecting stories from the community about deportations. So these are her interviews in Romani language and in Romanian. And here a book, a picture book for children in Poland that is produced in two Romani dialects and also in Polish and in English. So from one hand it incorporates the idea of the plurality of Romani dialects, but and also has these grand narratives about again the regions from India, what happened to the Roma in Poland, what happened to the Roma in Europe, and all of them actually, if you pick them, they are both they present the plurality of genres. So it's educational materials, it's literature, it's comics, but also like document. It can be used also as documents, as the one selected by Luminica. And I forgot to visualize here, these are the covers from the, so to say, first period, the Soviet Union publications. One really propaganda book in the new way. Then how Masha went to learn to school, and then talks about talks about the party and about the new life among the Roma. Here just example of the production, but they were like around 300 titles for a 10-year period, so quite an impressive in the Soviet Union. These are also Yugoslavian titles that are both in Romani language and also in Serbo-Croatian. And in Czechoslovakia, there were the Roma authors in the period of socialism, they rather published in periodicals at that time, later in small books similar to this. These are Hungarian authors also creating as part of the national Hungarian literature scene. The first, to, so to say, famous Romanists were Mateo Maximov, with his publications of novels, later also folklore and translation of the Bible, and in Finland, Veijo Balzer, who also became famous as novelist, creating in the national language, but on topics related to the life of the Roma. Sweden, where we have a very good picture book tradition that starts, so to say, since the 70s. And the huge production in the 90s, so we see here books from different countries. As I say, this reminds very much of this Herderian, so to say, model of collecting the corpus of folklore in order to register it as bearer of the Romani culture spirit. And Roma poetry, there is one saying of Santino Spinelli, who is activist, musician, professor, and a poet. He says every Roma is a poet, and really the huge production of poetry proves this this statement. And I really highly recommend this collection that is in English, The Roads of the Roma. It's a collection from Roma authors from different countries with very good English translation and with a very good introduction from Jan Hancock, providing a kind of context for the Romani movement and activism. And the autobiographical books, Jaya Stoika was the first in Austria to open up about the Holocaust memories. She said she was not supported by her family at the beginning, so the community's view was rather to keep silent about what we experienced, but she decided to open up, and then many other books. At this time, Filomena Franz in Germany published also stories of two women from Roma and Sinti region open up with pioneering works on their memories from the Holocaust. Ilona Lapskova also with a great work from Milena Hubsmanova. They stayed together. Ilona was telling her life story and they collected materials, so it was published in Czechoslovakia, and then with consequent translations into many languages. But an interesting fact is the English translation of the book is, as you see, a false down, My Life is a Gypsy Woman in Slovakia. And the original translation is, I was born under a lucky star. So actually, you know, the contradiction shows how we should perceive the communist regime, so to say, I think. And this is part of the comics. This is the original title, and these comics, personally, I think it's a very a very good book, and it has many also translations. I've been mentioned by the author that she's thinking, or there is a Romanian translation, but I'm not sure about it. She was mentioning something of the kind. And as so actually now we have, so to say, despite this is a young literature with not a very rich development in all genres, neither there is a national scale, there is no national book support for it, or distribution or a market or whatever, but there is still this Romani literature scene as a whole, because I claim that with the context of internalization and the activism and the possibility of authors and activists to talk to each other and to meet, we have a kind of already an international development, because we have authors meeting for competitions. We have many collections on national and international scale, translations of one Roma author to another language where a country where Roma live. And I think that with the growing of the phenomenon, so to say, also there is this Romani literature research scene developing, and I think that the approaches to it, as I see them, with older, with the notions of that this is a generalization, of course, first we have this encyclopedical approach, so documenting what was published, and since the 80s we have publications in periodicals about a certain Roma author or about a certain development from a country, and here are some titles. Also, the biggest account, the first account was on an international base, was done by Rajko Djuric, who spoke for the first time about literature by Roma and Sinti in German language. There are translation in other languages too. So this was the first type of to map the field, so to say. There was this approach of to theorize, to reflect on what is Romani literature. So, is it literature by Roma? Is it literature in one language that is Romani? Is it a literature that treats Roma topics and is written by Roma? And here we have the names of authors that were the first to reflect on it. For example, Beate Eder-Jordan, she claims that we should rather speak of literatures, not of a literature, having in mind very different context and backgrounds of the authors. And also in the end of 1990s, so to say, the Romani literature scholars started together. So there was forums organized in different universities, and the field started also to become international in a way. And the work of Paola Toninato devoted to the writings of the Roma, she is the first to actually reflect how different theories, like minority literature theory, diasporic literature theories, how they fit into the field of the Roman literature, and how useful they can be or they cannot be to interpret the pieces of Roma authors. And she's particularly interested of Romani Romani women. And something that I propose to be called like entangled history approach, interpreting of the literature pieces not as a literature, but just as part of the wider context of development of Romani issues, of Romani activism, because actually the authors we're speaking about are not just authors. Most of them are activists, human rights activists, Romani educators. So people really involved as intellectuals in the Romani movement, so they to a great extent act, so to say, as a chronicle of the past and as grand narrators in the absence of the national history narrative. They act as narrators of the history of the Roma. And As for the challenges of which I was thinking, is to how actually to when we interpret Romani literature, how useful could be a certain oppositions or certain approaches that we already see in Romani studies, like the opposition Roma versus non-Roma. So is it are the Romani literature voices, raising voices that are rather to create an identity of Roma towards the others, the non-Roma, or is it rather a interrelation or a repetition of a non-Romani literature development? So these are just things to reflect on, not clear answers, of course. And something I was already mentioning, the fiction and pure literature versus wider understanding of literature, like, for example, the oral history collection as a literature that can be used in literature classes or in education, and oral versus written that is already overcome, because many of the folklore stories that are actually, so to say, authorized by the Roma, so they are printed out under the name of a Roma author, without certain notes on this in the text. Actually, these are to a great extent community folklore collected by the author, but of course authorized somehow by him or her and published. And also, there something that is again challenging is since there is already a so to say Romani studies scholarship, more or less we see a growth in the recent decade of PhD production, of forums, of many books devoted to Romani studies, and Romani literature scholars are in a way not that actively participating or benefiting, so to say, of their of these developments. For example, the forums are organized devoted to Roman literature are rather organized in the in sections of world congresses of literature, and this is again a challenge how to combine the approaches and take benefit of the Romani studies scholarship. And something that is related to something that I call engagement. So if I was asked 10 years before, should a researcher be engaged with the community, meaning acting more on an activist basis, I would say no. I would say that you should be like distant from your studies and really be impassionate about it. But now with what we see in a European and global context, particularly also related to Roma and anti-Gypsyism, I think that it is the researcher. I think that as researcher, we have to be really engaged with the community and act also as an activist, without, of course, going out of the scientific boundaries and principles. And that's it from me. Thank you.
Many interesting issues raised. Any comments, questions?
You said about different types of literature. What do you mean by different types? As in different stories, different communities, different stories?
What I said, maybe I mean different genres, like tales, poetry. Yes. And of course, the novel, so to say, is the less developed genre if you have to look at it. But I think this is also a repetition of other literature's development. So
so there's a wide spectrum of all genres most covered by.
Yes, we can say so, with having in mind that novel is the total less developed.
I mean, it's interesting to. Issue that you raise here is that you speak about, I mean, there are different issues that you raise. First of all, Romani literature. Is there a common Romani literature that kind of unites Romani communities in different different both the national settings or is there not? I mean, can you speak of Romani literature as such, or Bulgarian Romani literature, or even subsections of that? First of all, that is one question that is very interesting to discuss.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, what you mentioned also, the kind of ownership of the literature, which is in some ways the same question as we discussed before. I mean, if you present a story, is it your story, or you as an individual author, or are you telling the story of a community that is kind of hidden behind you? Are you manipulating, or are you...
Yeah.
Are you stealing the stories? And in many ways, I mean, that's the same things as we just discussed before, when you're doing your history. Are you taking people's stories away from them, or not?
Well, for the publications of these folklore and materials or stories or tales or legends, myths, etc., collected from the community, there are, I would say, in the corpus of literature, two types of publication of such. One is ethnographic or the folkloristic. So researchers collecting, and publishing it with all the references needed about the context, the narrator, and the community. And such we have since the time of the first recordings of the Romani language. So, because the people recording, they were not all recording, sometimes they were recording vocabulary, but sometimes it was the talk. And another type would be an author belonging to a community that is also a holder of this oral tradition, so to say, publishing under his or her name the stories. Sometimes with the notes that these are stories of my grandma, but more often, at least the ones that I know from Southeastern Europe, such that are like authorized. So you can't, even maybe the author doesn't reflect that, is this the family oral narrative or is it the community? And of course they're always authorized. So it's never even the writing down and the retelling, it's already a new narrative. And often it's like this. And what is interesting in many ways, of course, is to see how the motives of the narratives, you know, to make this typological of the narratives and of different communities, are they stories that that overlap, and if they are diverse, what is the level of the diversity, and how they diverse, and how the author ends up. I think it's also, for me, it's interesting to see how an author takes a story and retells it, because if it's with the author's name, it's, I already consider it author's work, so to say. And for the, I claim that at least, and so to say, at the level of activism, of Romani activism, there is something like a common Romani literature already emerging, let's say in the last 10 or 15 years, because authors that are also activists, they communicate with each other, and to a great extent they share a kind of narratives about the Romani people. Sometimes, of course, they're different. But there are certain narratives that we see in the books, as for example the Polish book and the book from Sweden. You see the narratives about the Indian regions. That, of course, not the narrative of the community itself, but these are the narratives of the activists. And also about the narrative about the Holocaust, you can meet it in books in Macedonia and Bulgaria, authored by authors coming from communities that are not that don't have this experience of being victims of the Holocaust, but they narrate about this as an important point from the history of the Romani people in Europe. And in this sense,
I think we can claim about the emergence at, so to say, elitist level, whatever it means, of Romani literature. But when it comes to the community, of course, it's many questions are raised. Are these communities who read the Romani literature? Do they know about the authors? But at least I think that the most like famous names creating literature in the countries are known by the communities not they come from, but for I think Luminița is famous in a Romanian wide, so to say, scene. And more or less they are famous also at national level, and in Bulgaria also the Roma authors, or in Serbia they are known both to Roma and to non-Roma, due to many reasons, sometimes because just they appear in the media, not because they are well known by the community or they are read by the community.
Yes, I just wanted to ask something about the oral tradition or oral literature, because there is this cultural, historical or philosophical idea, folklorists had, that there is a tendency of the grand tradition that it will sink down, and then, for example, we collect some folk ballads or tales from the peasants, which used to be sometimes in the grand tradition, for example, Renaissance literature or something. So, and this was used in the Hungarian folkloristic very much, collecting ballads and fairy tales. These were the two genres collected among the Roma and published as part of the Hungarian oral tradition. Until there some anthropologists or ethnographers noted that, for example, the ballads among the Roma are bound to several situations which are quite different than from the majority society. They are sung only in funeral wakes, for example. Mm-hmm. And the people were reluctant to sing these ballads for the purpose of being recorded, because they said that it's bound to somebody will die in the family or something bad is happening. So I'm wondering if this tendency of going down is as you observe in Bulgarian or other traditions, this is used also in a similar manner.
Yes.
Because now, of course, what we are speaking about is quite the reverse. The canonization of the Roma literature as high culture, so it's quite the reverse. But I'm curious if you can see this other.
Yes, I think in the countries that I've observed in Southeastern Europe, it's indeed the notion of let's collect and record and publish in order to preserve the oral heritage is a very well-presented discourse and motive for collection and publication of materials. And even from the activists from the old generation, they are always complaining, if we don't record it, we're losing the language, we're losing this oral heritage. And I think this notion is quite strong. And some researchers are saying, yeah, we already lost the generation, we can't, the new generations can't tell that in this good way what we recorded so far. But actually I'm not that much worried about it, because the stories are living in another way, so to say. So also it's a question about what is traditional story and how it transforms. So they are always thought, but this motive of publications in order to preserve it is quite strong in Bulgaria, of course, and I think Serbia, Macedonia, Croatia also.
I have another question. I imagine that it can be quite expensive to publish these books, and I wanted to ask where the funds come from, whether, I don't know, maybe publishing houses or political actors have any say in this.
In Southeastern Europe, so to say, the publications are done mainly by non-governmental organizations within the grants that they received from foreign funders. It was mainly open society funders to publish
such materials, whereas in a kind of in Austria, in Germany, and in the UK, in some cases of the UK, these are publishers specified in minority literature publications that are actually professional publishers. Sometimes, in most often, they get grants from the government, local or national, to publish such books. But publishing by professional publisher gives more chance for distribution. That means that if you go to Germany or Austria, there is more chance for you to find in the bookshops the publications. Whereas if you go to Bulgaria, it's quite, though the number of books published by Roma authors and in Romani are more than in Austria, you can't find them in the in the bookshops. It's a kind of, because when professional publisher knows how to act in the distribution network, so to say, whereas an NGO rather distributes it within events. As for example, this book of Minutes, I don't know, is it some publisher or it's a grant. It's rather a grant, and I guess, so I get it from Minutes, but I doubt if you could find it even before upon publication in a bookshops. Of course, it's a question of are the bookshops interested also. But it's also an issue. It's an issue with this engagement, because when there are people interested to read, can they find this literature?
How about just releasing it on the internet?
Sorry?
How about just releasing it on the internet?
Yeah.
You have the grant for it, you published it, okay, but the main scope is for people to read it, right? To get it to many more people.
Yes. Yeah, that's a good idea. I would say not that much used by the internet opportunities are not really used so far.
But for example, the book of Luminica Trouba is published on the internet, uh-huh. Not the entire book, but the main part of the book.
Uh-huh.
Is,
of this.
Yes, yeah, yes, so yes. This. So it's available for free. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I think we need to move on. Thank you, Sofiya.
Yeah.
The last to speak in this session is László Fosztó, and he's going to speak on the challenges in documenting the relationships between institutions within and without the community. And this is a case study of cultural practices in 2003.
Well, I was thinking about showing some record which is not only the narrative but also some images. Maybe we will have just time to have a short video. But the main idea was to propose this, that we are working on the boundary between our formal institutions and the institutions of the community. Because of course, definitely, life stories are living within the community as well. So people tell life stories to each other, and when we record them for the purpose of anthropological research or for the purpose of historical research, then we enter in with one institutional approach to another world, and that world react to somehow, but we might even encounter some already pre-established patterns of telling the life story. And to give an example, if you go to a converted Pentecostal community, then people have a very, very good sense of how they should present their conversion narrative, because the conversion narrative is a story which people exercise very often. So they tell this story also within the assembly and tell as a testimony. So people, when talk about themselves, they have an idea of the sinful past and then how they made a meeting with God, and then life has changed and everything is different. So there is a structure already there. And what I wanted to show now, that how there is a general idea that what is religion in our world, and if this idea that the secularization happened quite widespread, and the separation between the state and the church and the religion is more and more going down to the private sphere, I misspelled, sorry. And there is a morality which is more like secular in the world, and the solidarity in the community will be based more on civis and citizenship ideas. But when we go to do research, we encounter other events on the field. And for example, observing the community, you see that there is a religious calendar. There is a strong calendar of the life, and that's linked to certain events which are coming from the religion, and that's not so much changing. Also in the Roma communities, there are some new events. Of course, there are celebration quite recently, until beginning from 2011, the 20th of February as the day of the emancipation. We just celebrated a couple of days ago, and there is an 8th of April for the International Roma Day. But compared to the older celebration, older cycle of the year, they are relatively new and relatively not so much penetrating into the local communities. Of course, there is a life cycle with baptism, marriage and funeral, which ethnographers have documented for long, and I went down the traditional way to start with baptism this today, and we'll show some elements of it. And I just emphasize also the new movements, the new religious movements, which are the topics for a different talk. But this time I speak about Calvinist baptism, which I this is the region where I did research for this. It's not far from here, as you see, it's westward. And this region is the traditional ethnographers in the Hungarian ethnographers. Call it Kalotaszeg, Zona Kalata in Romanian, which is traditionally perceived as a Hungarian ethnic region with strong Hungarian traditions like this. So this is a baptism among the Hungarians, as you see. These are four costumes, and it has its own history, how it emerged. So it's not so old as some claim that this is ancient, but it's more like 19th century, as it became so much decorated, but it is perceived as a national heritage, and it's also perceived. And if you look at the Roma, they are dressed quite differently, and they usually perceive this as a modern. So they are dressed in a more like a way of the urban, but there is one element of the traditional. What the Hungarians practice also. And there are other things, because what you see here is not the whole family, but these are just the kirve, just the nashi. So they are all godparents. So that there are like 10 pairs of godparents around the church, registering just one. They have the book for one pair, but they are coming. And then the church has a situation when many godparents are coming, and I know that this is happening because the Hungarians are doing the same. The historical explanation, according to some Hungarian ethnographers, is that the number of children decreased because of the inheritance system, so they don't want it to share the land that much. And then, in order to keep the social relations extended, the number of the godparents been multiplied. So this is a very simple arithmetical explanation. I'm not sure that this is the only one. So, but I'm just going to show a short, maybe how the formal institution dealing with the emerging differences which are coming from the institutions within the community. Maybe the title is a bit strange or puzzling, that without or within. The without, I mean that outside, and within, that is coming from the community. And I attended several baptisms, and as I had the technical equipment there, I was also invited to make videos about it. So this video, what I'm showing, it's cut from a longer material, which was actually commanded by the family, and I gave them. And they gave me, in exchange, the right to use for research what I recorded, but of course it's never published, or it's not something that is house where the baptism taking place, and all everybody's coming with a very large cake, which is of course a sign of abundance and sharing the food, and also many pairs of working, and now
it started first.
Yes, let's try it. So that this was a recording. As you see, this is inside the house, and only males are inside. There is one woman coming and taking the note, but. There is a gender segregation, which is, of course, very typical as a first seeker. I was watching the images that you had access more to the female sphere, but how this... they are collecting these cakes, you can see, and a small name tag is put on them for each family. So this is this kind of situation when the Roma control themselves, the situation, they are organized, they use as they want. And then I will jump just a bit to show when they go on the street. So this is the female part. They are the godmothers. And outside the guys are having a drink and waiting for the further guests. Girl who will be baptized. So they start from the house. In a, you see that they are lined up, they are the godmothers, and then the males are coming in the back. They are taking the girl to the church. So in a classical ritual theory, this would be the liminal phase when there is a separation from the community, from the household, and taking to the outside institution, to the church, and leading to the institution baptizing. So these are the boys in the back. This is the traditional Calvinist church in the area. The church is usually having a Hungarian pastor, so this Calvinism in Transylvania is associated with the Hungarian ethnicity, and as they line up, they are waiting for somebody to come and they gather some money to give to the church. And he is the janitor of the church, and making them kind of educating them, controlling and disciplining them how to behave. So there is, of course, it's quite a asymmetric situation, and the Roma know that they are under supervision somehow by the church, and as they go inside and the baptism is being performed. So these are all I think that she's the last. No, she's the last of the Kirche. There are 10 godmothers. And these are the. And when they go inside, there is a. This is how they are organized specially. The rest of the community is not even attending the baptism because they are not that much interested in this part of the ceremony, because they have another part when they go back. They go actually to the culture house in the center of the city, which is showing quite a good balance of the local community, that Roma are using the same culture house as the Hungarians, and so they are not excluded from there. And actually, Hungarians are also attending this. And one of the godmothers is a Hungarian, and the main godfather is also a Hungarian. So this is also a way of ensuring the connection with the Hungarian community, and the way of getting a sponsorship. So the guy who is a taxi driver in this case is expected to contribute to the ceremony, and he is aware of this, but always there is a balance, so that he will not exaggerate in contributions. And there is some tension around the money always. There is one moment of the evening when the money is gathered. So. Probably is well known from other ethnic communities also. Yeah, some more cakes are coming and the party is starting. So they are the main godparents, both of them Hungarians, local Hungarians, and this is the grandfather and the child. And there is a separate part of the scene. Actually, there's a scene in the front, and the here where the godmothers and the godfathers are staying together, and they are making the party, so a dance scene. And this is the part, and the dance, I cut it short here, but they liked more, and this was what they expected me to film and to participate. And the girls are dancing, and she is the newly baptized small girl. So some more people are coming, and the party is heating up until the last moment, around midnight. There is this collection of the money, and then those who feel they can go, and the others are staying and making the party further. So. You see that there are much more people participating in the baptism than those who are attending the church, because the church is seen also as a kind of outside institution and different. Are very changing. So there are Hungarian traditional music, and this is more like a Romanian consumer music. So this is the event when the money is collected. This is a taxi driver. He's exaggerating the amount that he will give, because he's such a successful taxi driver that he can make 10 million of lei in just one round of going around the city. He gives 100 euros, which is a fair. Five dresses also for the girl, and he claimed that when the girl is going, then he will. He should buy also a small piglet and some money for the musicians. So I did this as part of my earlier work in the editing in the Max Planck Institute when I was a PhD student there. And now I go back to the presentation. So there are there is this difference, of course, in the dressing, as I said, and in the what the church wants and how much the church wants to canonize the dressing. This is another event where the Roma and Hungarians are together, but you cannot tell the difference because everybody is dressed in a Hungarian ethnic costume in order to hide the ethnic differences. And of course, because the Hungarian the community wants to show the vitality of the Hungarian community, that they are so strong. The half of them are Hungarian Roma, so they are also speaking Hungarian and being in the same church as a church community, but they are definitely having separate institutions. They don't need their marriage, for example. And they are also doing this kind of images separately. And this is just the Roma cohort from the confirmation ceremony, which again is a similar object as I produce for them with this filming, because they keep in the household and sometimes people can take it out and talk about, and probably methodologically is also useful for oral historians also to take out a family album or family picture and talk about. But what is not so visible in the surface, this is the structure of the where the Kirve are coming, who are the godparents. And you see that quite balanced. Here is the baptized child and the mother and the father. And from both sides, they are trying to bring in young couples in order to have this the family network extended and balanced. And when I asked about this, it's quite a conscious choice about. And there is one family which is totally unrelated, you see here. And they are the Gadje. So they are the non-Roma godparents, and they are, as you see, they are not part of the kinship structure. So it's... it's important when you make an interview or when you speak with people, and if you ask about godparents, they usually don't mention this Gadje or this non-Roma godparents, but the others, or one of the others who are more important, and all of the rest, I would say that they are maybe for the fun or for the party, so they don't have so much obligations, but... In this event, and this is a more urban setting, but it's happening the same. And I just go to this last slide. So if we look at what where we get the narratives from, the individuals, from the household, we always have other circles around them. And how we can access that, of course, the observation is important, and such events like rituals or celebrations are always good opportunities for, because you are invited and you are not making any disturbance or very little disturbance to the events, and then you can ask later questions about what happened. So oral historians probably have some benefit also of attending the wedding if you are invited, so I would say that you should go. And later that is a kind of really good source for the interpretation and understanding what is going on within the structure of the community, and then we can relate also, of course, to the larger institutional environment. And what I just skipped, this is a guide for best practices for religious denominations. It's culte religioase. It sounds in English sounds a bit like cult or like sex, something different. But in Romanian doesn't have this connotation. And it was published by the Romanian government, as you see, that there is also a way of influencing or trying to get the churches on working with the Roma communities and how what are the good practices. And this guide had a particular history. Some of you might know that the, originally was commissioned by somebody who was a non-Orthodox Christian. And then when he submitted, it was not the office was not happy with it, so that they commissioned another one, which is more proper, which has also mainly these the main denomination like Orthodox Christians better represented, they say. I cannot go into detail about this, but definitely going through a church or having the church as one case study or institution and looking at how church influences the events and institutions which the community organizes for themselves, like rituals or mainly life cycle rituals, then we can have an insight. Documenting these rituals here and here might be the point for the ethical issue, because I understood that today we should discuss this more, is that how and what is the status of this kind of documentation, what you might do for the community, for they ask for pictures, and you can use it as a very good door opener, because you can then bring back pictures and give pictures, and then you don't take the money for it, and then people are discussing with you. But are these good research materials as well, or how you make people understand with informed consent that what you recorded is not just for the sake of their own memory, but it's becoming part of a larger institutional structure, and what we are doing with this, it's quite beyond their reach, actually. So this what is the end question for also getting back to this dilemma of having the names. Of course, the baptism is about the name, so the child being given a name in the community, I never use the name, and I never use the name of the family either. But yes, there is a personal element in this, and what I'm when I write about such events, in particular baptism, it's about social identity of the child, giving within the community an identity to the child. But yes, it's a question mark to my approach, that why shouldn't we do more about recognizing? In some cases, when there is no danger for recognizing some of the personal names. Of course, the classical answer to that you might do later some other publication from the material you have, which then endanger the community, because originally you publish the name and then you cannot publish other more sensitive issues. For example, of course, when living in this community, I also take part in going for the woods in the forest and taking woods, which might be considered illegal or even stealing woods. And so these events, which I never put on paper, but this is part of anthropological work. So I will stop here and with this dilemma, which I of course I would like to discuss with you.
Thank you. Questions, comments?
Yes, I have a question. Do the Bajie are really necessary to be part of the baptism or not? Because in Cortorai and Cortorai, conservative communities, the Bajie were very important, as it was the element not to get, not to have other obligations within the community. So they avoided being baptized, having godfathered, being godfathered by Romas as well. So the preferred culture, actually, because it was more...
Yeah, it's keeping at a distance.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a kinship politics. It might be different from one community to the other. In this case, the Gajer were there, but they were not so crucial. They were crucial in the act of asking for money, of course. But later on, in some other situations, one colleague of us has written about this, and she said that economically, it's beneficial also to have the gadget, that later you can go and borrow money or ask for work as a day laborer, and this kind of officializing or having in the church in the ritual context
it's also a public recognition of the trustworthiness of the family. And but not this element that you just said about not creating additional obligation. Here the obligations were there, that there were Roma present, but usually they were so young, as you see, that they were not expecting to be major contributors or major sponsors for the event or for the church later. And they were, some of them were not members of the church, so it's not which is not exceptional, because in the Balkans, for example, you have Muslims being godparents for Christians, which is not impossible if you are the main patron of the event, or you are the you are considered to be the godfather, but somebody else goes to the church, and the church records something that is not important for the sake of the institutions within the community.
Thank you very much, Pastor. This is really very interesting. I was interested, is there, or if you are aware, if there is this kind of godfathership by chance or on a crossword, or crossword, so in the Balkans, at least in former Ottoman lands, the mothers first have encountered if the children within the family are dying at very early age, then the next to be born is put on a road, on a crossword, and the first to be met becomes a godfather or a godmother. Have you encountered such a...
I never met this idea, but it might. It's more elaborate in the Balkans in several places.
Yes,
like
yes.
Emanuel Hammer has written from demographical perspective, and he said that kumstvo is a,
yes,
one of the principles of kinship. So it's not just descent and alliance, of course, marriage and and descent, but kumstvo, which means that you create by ritual connections with others, and how this is connected to religion, definitely.
And are there any differences in baptizing a boy and a girl? Have you encountered
such things? No, they are both the same, and even they dance with the child in the same manner. Not in this community.
Mm-hmm. I think we need to have coffee. thank you very much, László. It's very interesting. And, this session is over, and we will meet again in half an hour.
20 minutes.
She's very good in working with the archive, and we all go in the archives, but it's better to go after she was there and she's able to guide us between the huge amount of documents, people that are more willing and open to give you certain documents and so on. So, and I think her contribution to the project overall is crucial. So she will speak about precisely this, how are the Roma visible or invisible in the communist archives, and how is this possible to find them there.
Thank you very much for your introduction, Lavinia. So I'm you can see the title of my paper is someone has a negative connotation. It is impossible to use archives in order to study the history of Roma people. So, as you can imagine, the subject of my presentation, how can one use archives in order to study the history of Roma people during the communist period? So, why that's impossible, in my title, why I put a question mark? Because when I start and working, I came into several problems regarding, first of all, the sources, which for me are the archives. So, These archives are mainly created by institutions, and for the last decades of the period, they are mainly unavailable because for legal reasons. Many and what I also want to highlight is the fact that being created by a certain institution, they held a specific type of information according to the profile of the institution that created them, and that is a problem for the person who wants to study the problem. So I also noticed that the question of Roma people, it's of sporadic interest for the Romanian state. They prefer to most of the time to ignore it. So we don't have a lot of information about it. And also another problem is that many of few institutions were required to gather information about this population. And for legal reason again, the archives are not available yet, some of them. And also I found very puzzling, I'm nervous and I'm not very coherent. So actually, I found another issue that represents an impediment for someone who wants to study the history of Roma people from the archive. And I think the diversity of this population is one factor. They are spreading. All over the country, in all regions, both in rural and urban areas. They have different professions and they enjoy a certain social mobility. That's why it's difficult to study them. And also they have very religious options from Orthodox, Catholic, Neo-Protestant, Protestant, Islamic, depending on their place of residence. Some of them during the communist period they have nomad, semi-nomad way of living. And also they don't have institutionalized form of organization, only on the local level, from what I read so far. And they were considered ethnic groups. They were considered population, but not they were not granted the status of a national minority. And they actually represent for the communist regime many social problem, not a political problem. Or I don't know. And the solution. How can I surpass these difficulties when I'm going to write my book or my papers and so on? I will not document how diachronically how the communist regime reacted to a certain problem posed by the community. In exchange, I will try to answer the several questions. When and why the regime reacted to the issue of Roma people and how it defined the problem, how it sees the problem. Because from my point of view, it's very important to know how the communist regime interpreted, how it looked at this minority. Okay, so I will answer this question: when and why the regime reacted to the problems of the Roma people. My research in the center archives pointed to two important moments during the 70s and the 80s of 70s, and this period also had programs and policies designed to ensure the social integration of this population. Why the 70s? Because the communist regime adopted a maximalist policy towards its national minorities, although they don't actually recognize Roma people as a national minority by the language and the discourse regarding Roma people is similar to all kind to the official discourse regarding national minority being German Hungarian Turkish Tatar because I'm dealing with that. And why in 1977? First of all, the beginning of this year, the population census indicated an impressive growth of this population. The official numbers were this, but other numbers. They were vehiculated in numbers more than half a million or 1.7 million Roma people. So these numbers, this increase in the number of the population raised the awareness of the regime towards this population. That was more, that was not actually integrated. It was not participating in the building of the social of the socialist society, and I also look at the general political context. During the 70s, the Romanian regime promoted a nationalist policy with the purpose of creating a unified socialist nation. So any kind of cultural cultural differences, they should be leveled in order to create this unified socialist nation. And also, the regime was on the road of building this socialist society where the welfare of the citizen was supposed to be granted for all of them. First of all, the regime defined the problem of Roma people as a social problem first and as a political problem. So I'm going to show you several pictures that illustrate a study prepared for the senior party leaders about the social and economic situation of Roma people. So first of all, they underline a series of causes that transform Roma people into a social problem. Most of all, lack of education, unemployment, extreme poverty, precarious sanitary condition that favor the spreading of a serious contagious disease. And for most of them, for the regime, the Roma people were the delinquent by the definition. I mean, they don't have a middle ground. For them, the gypsy story is the delinquent. So here is several pictures that I found in the archives that illustrate the dimension of the social problem posed by Roma people. I don't have any details about the photograph or something. Just that they came as an illustration of the report prepared for the party. So how can I use this one for writing the history of Roma people? Okay, first of all, I want to find the key elements of the official policy towards population in order to underline if there is a change in this policy. What are the problems? What type of problems they identify? How they supposed to deal with it? What are the results? What are the failures of this policy? And I also find elements of everyday life. I know it's a little bit strange for someone who doesn't do an archive work to find this kind of stuff, but there are several mention about the disappearance of tradition, about the awakening of the tradition, about the celebrations, how they transformed during the period. So, and also found details regarding the local organization of the Roma people, because the Romanian authorities were very interested in what were the leaders of the community, what is their attitude towards the regime. They are going, they are encouraging people to integrate into the Romanian society, to give up their traditional way of living and start working as working in a factory or something. We find specific details about this. The more actually interesting during the 80s, if there are any intellectuals in this community, because they were afraid, and I will speak about it later, about birth of a national movement within this community, and intellectuals were regarded as being the spoken man for the community in its relation to the local authorities. And also, what I found very interesting, there is no sharp division between we Roma people and the authorities, because members of the communities choose to be informers of the militia, of the securitate. So we cannot portray Roma people as being the victim of the Romanian authorities, because I think it offers us a more nuanced images about the relation between the regime and the Romanian authorities. Okay, for me this was quite a surprise to identify in the archives of the former secret police, the Securitate, as you all know, that Roma people was a political problem for the regime. Why is that? And I found several answers. I know that they are not definitely answer. And first of all, there is a rise of small elite preoccupied of gaining for this population the status of a national minority, and one of them, which is the sociologist Gheorghe Nicolae, which I'm intending to write something about him, but at this stage of my research I can give you more. No more than general details. And another reason for the interest of the Securitate into the Roma people was, I use a very fashionable way, a transnational dimension. Some of the leaders that elite I was talking about had contacts with the international academic community. They have foreign relations. They receive letters, they send letters, they receive books, and so on. So this is a problem for the regime. And also they have all kind of connection with Roma international organization. And I only found these two. I'm sure there are more, and I apologize for the last name of the organization. I don't know if it is correct. I haven't checked yet, but it's something that appears in my document. So this is another problem, because when they go to these kind of international conferences, and they tend to speak about the hard situation of Roma people in Romania. This is a problem for the regime. And also, foreign religious associations are interested in the situation of Roma people, because of their religion, no Protestant religion. So it's no Protestant domination. Sorry. So this is actually another problem. A foreigner comes and is interested in the situation of these people. And another surprise, I didn't imagine that I could find something like that. some of the people were identifying the archives as being as having a hostile attitude towards the regime. And this, I will give you several examples because I haven't finished my documentation yet. And here is the case of Roma people in Reșița who managed to open a church, I quote, in Gypsy language. They were fined by the local authorities, and they threatened that if they are not allowed to open again the church, they are going to go to American embassy or send a letter to Radio Free Europe. So this is why a totally issue that it's more of local authorities of competence came into the focus of the security. Another one is some sort of Varga Gheorghe, who wrote a poem, the trilogy of the gypsies, and also wrote a gypsy dictionary. So he wanted to publish them. So this is actually a problem because they were considered to be a manifestation, a wanted manifestation of the gypsy nationalism. And another case from Iași County. It was illegal to multiply papers during the communist regime in Romania. There were strict regulation regarding printing, reprinting something, typing machine, etc. That's why it's more. Oh, sorry. Have I done something wrong?
No. It's not you. It's automatic.
No. So here is about a paper that this guy had it from a Congress of Gypsies in England. So he wanted to multiply, and he was also interested in promoting the cultural specificity of his people. He intended to organize competition of dances, songs, and so on. And the last one, which is a little bit local initiative from Mureș County. This guy sent a memorandum to the central party in the state leader, which is very much, and asked for a creation of a national organization of gypsies of the Romania, which was supposed to take place in Târgu Mureș, and he proposed himself to be the president of it. So he didn't have much success because the security intervened and convinced him that it was not a good idea to organize this type of organization. And also one interesting thing is it's a case of a lady who organized legal trips for Roma people in Romania to Hungary. From there they were helped by other gypsies in order to go to Western Europe. They have an entire strategy how to do that. They go to Bedete or OJT, which are the main offices for tourist officer. They actually booked legally this kind of trip, and they go to Hungary, and from Hungary they did not come back to Romania. And the last one, this was a very courageous guy, because on the National Day he intended to go in the front of the center committee building with a placard and to protest against the fact that the regime reject his request for leaving the country for medical treatment. I don't know if it was for medical treatment or just he just wanted to flee the country. Another issue which I didn't get much time to study, I still need time to document it. Roma people as a political their religious belief, because they were most of them were belonged to because they are option to no Protestant dominations. So the denomination. Sorry and thanks.
This was a very good synchronization.
Okay.
Thank you, Manuela, for your very interesting presentation. If there are questions, comments, suggestions, Sofiya?
Thank you very much. The work in archives always gives, it's a golden mind of it, very time-consuming.
Yes, I know.
And I'm just making parallels with Bulgaria, where, let's say, the socialist regime was, in the same logic, more restrictive, like security services working and so on. And recently we have one, let's say, activist, non-Roma, but working with the Roma, who published lots of archives. He was searching in the archives and published them online, what he found. And for me, one thing, because you mentioned that these were institutions, different types, but in many of them, the documents written were written by Roma. For example, the Communist Party has a separate division working with minorities, one of the people there being a Roma. So he himself was responsible for this, and there was this a newspaper in Bulgarian that devoted totally to the gypsy population, to enlighten them in the socialist way of life and so on. And also people working for the security services were Roma, many of them. So I was wondering, did you encounter such things and documents in your work?
Yes, like I mentioned, during the 17th, during the first 6 years of the communist regime, there is a special department, but within the Romanian government, who is not a department for national minorities. So actually, they made huge studies about all kinds of minorities, including gypsies. And as for the collaboration of the Roma people with the security, yes, I found, but I didn't manage to read all the personal files, because you have to read and reread and recheck the information. Because when I encounter a name, I actually look for it to see if he has a surveillance file, if he was an informer. There are also cases when he is also under the surveillance of the Securitate, and he also give notes about people around him. So it's a more complicated thing, and I don't want to jump to the conclusion before I made a future research, so that's why. But there is cases and very famous ones, so it's more like I still need to document more.
And I have also a question, maybe it's more about the project management. Do you plan these documents that are found, because they're really very valuable documents? I'm making again parallel with this the Bulgarian guy who really did such a great job, and then he put it, and then now colleagues are doing from different, they're interested, for example, of the Romani movement in one locality, in one city, and then instead of going to the archives, they just use the online connection to scan documents. So I wonder if this is part of the project idea, or you would rather...
Oh, we are not allowed to put on the website the scanned documents, but we are allowed to reproduce it, and I started working on the such a volume of documents, which will include the documents from the party archives, state archives, and also from the Securitate archives. So it's something that I'm planning to finish at the end of this year. So hopefully next year we'll have the volume.
Yeah, in fact, this is one way of proceeding with this kind of different sources, oral sources and written sources. So I'm working on both publishing interviews with introduction and publishing documents with introduction. And of course there are ways of bringing both documents together when we do analysis and articles and stuff. Other questions? Gabi?
Yes, please, I would like to ask you if you know more about the growth of Roma towards a new Protestant movement in terms of, I don't know, like statistics or something like this.
Like I told you, I didn't start to document this yet, because like I told you, there are many religion, and it's quite difficult. I mean, the archive of the Ministry of Religious Affairs is huge. I mean, I have to take every denomination in order to find which is kind of, I don't know, I need at least 3 or 4 weeks in the archive. So I didn't go to study the archives of the Ministry of Religious Affairs, but in the summer I'll go there, and maybe I can answer your question, but I'm sorry, I didn't start to document that.
Yeah, you referred to some documents addressing elements of preservation, disappearance of traditions.
Yes.
Could you expand a bit on that?
Sorry.
What kind of documents?
Oh, what kind of document? First of all, like I told you, during the 70s and at the end of the 70s, we have all kind of studies made by different institutions, like Ministry of Interior, National Commission of Demography, sanitary or institutions, Ministry of Education, that came together and made a report. So first of all, we have this kind of reports.
Why was I doing this?
Because like I told you, in the 70s there is a preoccupation of the regime towards its national minorities. They don't know anything because there is a regime change. They know little things about this minority, this type of minority or population. And during the end of the 70s there is a huge growth of this population in terms of numbers. So it's more okay. We have this growth, and we have a problem because they actually represent a social problem. They don't integrate into this society. And the document mentioned that most of the people don't want to work in a factory. Not all of them. Some of them don't want to work in a factory. They don't want to attend a school. They live in extreme poverty. That's why they make research. They try to find a solution, and they also look at the experience of the other countries, including Bulgaria, Yugoslavia, and how they managed to solve to deal it with this problem. These are my explanations. I don't know if there is all the explanation possible, but this is something that I was thinking about and wrote. And the other types of documents, they are also from the Securitas, there are reports sent from the counties to Bucharest, to the central headquarters in Bucharest, about something that you find suspicious about this more. And we also have personal files of the characters. I mean, where they gather all kind of information about who is meeting the person, what he gets for lunch, and who is meeting with whom, what is he reading and so on, writing for most of them. I wish I answer your question.
Yes, first of all, I don't recall the fact that in officially documents produced by the communist regime, they use this notion of national minority. I think that they use
co-inhabiting
nationalities, which is and this thing is very important.
Yes, I wrote that in my slide, but I thought that it will be more easily for me to term it national minority. I know the term.
For the policy towards the minorities, that's about national minorities, the fact that they use that expression and syntax. Because, as you know very well at the beginning of the fifth piece, the communist government, promoted a specific style of policy toward the minorities. And then in the 60s, and especially in the second part of the 60s and the 70s, there was another policy towards minorities. I think we could call that policy sort of assimilation policy. And I think that in this large framework, the issue of Roma people can be discussed in this term. Second thing, as we know, in this in Romania, what the government, the communist government, recognized was the historical minorities. That means Hungarians and Germans, not other minorities.
And also the Turks and Tatars. Sorry. They're actually made said about them, so it's actually a minority for them.
It wasn't a minority for them, because they were targeted as a population which has to be assimilated.
No, not exactly, because
in cultural terms, just show me one textbook in Roma language in the 80s in Romania.
In the 80s, no. I've already mentioned that this this interest in the 70s is related to the national project of creating a unified socialist nation, and also to the plans of
okay,
building
a
prosperous socialist society. So
what means this kind of national community? Not presuppose a policy of assimilation in cultural terms.
Yes,
if you want homogeneity,
but
kind of policies are you producing?
No, I was pointing out that there is a difference between the policy towards national minority during the 70s and the 80s. So that's why I was pointing out, because in the 70s, for the Turkish and Tatar and also for the Roma, there is no such thing as assimilation or something like that. They only thought that we should encourage the local feature of this population in order to be co-opted in the building of the new yes, but there is an accent put on preserving the national specificity. Sorry, so it's something that I've noticed during my my research in the archives in the case of the of Turks and Tatars. They're encouraging, they are opening cultural houses for the national minorities, for these two minorities. They were thinking of publishing books, but they didn't in the for these minorities. So it's quite a difference between these two. Because Robert King said that during the 70s the regime pursued a maximalist policy towards the national minority. We are giving them more encourage. We are respecting their rights, their specificity compared to this to the 70s and 80s, where it's a level of these national differences, cultural, economical, and so on. So.
Okay, I think we have to move to the next presentation, and definitely we're gonna have some time in the end to continue with our discussion. So, Adi Boda is my colleague since forever.
I'm not that
bad. Since the beginning. He's very passionate about army and weapon stuff, which I sometimes don't understand, but he's really good at what he's doing. He's about to finish his PhD now on...
That's a new one.
About the perception of the enemy and the friend during the Second World War within the Romanian army. And now he will speak, of course, again, the army. but the role play by the Roma in the army.
Well, more or less this was a natural development of my interest in the army. So in this project I'm trying to get the perspective of the Roma serving in the Romanian army and trying to find something, some studies on some books about this. I found out that there isn't any kind of books about treating the story of the Roma people in the army, in the communist period. I found something written in Bulgaria by Ventro Krasted and Eugenia Ivanova. Yes, about, but it's about the Second World War and the Roma veterans from the Second World War, pictures most of it and their stories. So, getting started, I want to say that from a historical perspective, the army played in Romania, the army played an important role in all of these important events in the Romanian history, like the Russo-Turkish War and the Romanian independence. And starting from 1859 and the adoption of the Constitution of 1866, the compulsory military service was adopted in Romania. So, in every major event like this, the military service was very important. In because the people were drafted to military service and they fought for their country in every major conflict in the 20th century. And after the communist regime came to power, I think that the army was one of the important pillars of the communist regime in increasing the attachment of the individuals to the regime. This was one of my questions in the interview regarding the activity of the so-called political officers in the army and what was they trying to convince the soldiers, the usual soldiers, about the communist regime and his, and their love of the country. We'll get to that later in the presentation. So my main research target group was Roma aged between 40 and 70 years old, because after 72, as we'll see later, it was a national decree in which was stated that the young recruits, which already had two children, minor children under 7 years old of age, were allowed not to do this military service. So I wanted to see in the first part the experience of the Roma aged between this between 40 and 70 years old now, which are now this age. And I've already done some interviews, which are not included in this presentation, about the experience of the Roma ethnics at the end of the communist regime and after the 1990s, but it will be not in this presentation. And second, I wanted to have another perspective about the Roma ethnics, and that's coming from the Romanian and Hungarian and Germans, German ethnics, who served as comrades in arms of the Roma ethnics during their time in the army. And the main topics of the research were the army as a space of comradeship, which surpasses ethnic barriers. As I have not introduced fragments of the interviews, I can say to you that from the interviews it sounds like this, because everybody was equal in the army, they all were brothers in arms, so they were eating together, sleeping together, have bath together, have military service together, and everything was done together, Romanian, Hungarian, German, Roma ethnics and other ethnic groups. My questions was about in the interview guide was about the experience of the military service, if they saw it as a period of disruption in their biographies, so as for the many of them this was the first time they were outside of their communities, the first time ever. 90% of it said to me that it was the first time they were outside of their communities, they were far away from their families. And that's why I wanted to ask, I asked how are they keeping in touch with the families during this period, especially due to the fact that many of them were illiterate. And another set of questions was about daily life during the military experience, about the food, about free time in the army, about how were the clothing and personal hygiene, because when we go now in their communities, in some communities we saw that there were no personal hygiene, or they lack even plumbing in their villages or something like this, and I wanted to see how the fact that they had all of this in the army affected them. And I wanted also to see if they saw how they saw the army service, or like a positive or negative experience. And in 90%, even almost 100%, said that it was a positive experience for them, something like a school of life. Where they learned lots of things. And about the challenges that affected the quality of my interviews, my personal interviews, because this part of the experience in the army was just only a small part of the interview guide. So I also asked the other questions which are in our interview guide. So my first observation is that in comparison with my interviewing experience within the veterans of the Romanian army in the Second World War, which I met usually at their places, we had some inappropriate places to conduct oral history interviews, on the roadsides, in open spaces with lots of noises in the background, house yards, and everybody was around us, so it wasn't the best place for me to do an oral history interview. Another thing is that I didn't have the capacity to implement a proper sampling method, such as a snowball or something like this, which I've used in my interviews with the veterans. And I think that in some cases the presence of the group and community leader made some of the interviewees censor their discourse about their experiences, not especially the army. The army was usually seen as a positive experience, and they are talking very much about it. And in my case, another challenge was the fact that I've made this is not a good thing, but which I am trying to not to do in the future. I was wearing sometimes a military outfit when I go on the research, and I've had cases not in Sebeș, but in Sighișoara, where people were reluctant to talk to me because they associate me with the police or military member. So I won't wear that in the future when I go on the research. As I was saying, another set of challenges was the background studies in dealing with my research. The lack of studies on this topic. I haven't found on the internet anything about this topic. Only this one, Gypsy Roma in the Bulgarian Army during the Second World War, which is about the same kind of subject. Even in Romania, we have a lack of written sources about Roma who served in the army. I've had an idea to establish a geographic pattern, but it is impossible because the conscripts were assigned in different military units all over the countries. I've had interviews with people who are from Sebeș or from Sighișoara who were sent to Bucharest in the Securitate units, or to Constanța, or to, I don't know, every county of this of Romania. And in the army, the Roma was not treated as a distinctive ethnic group. They were equal citizens with everybody else. So it's difficult to see how this differs with other ethnic groups or Romanian recruit. And it's very difficult. I wanted to assess the number of Roma recruits, but I don't think that will be possible in a search based on names or even by census results. About the interviewing process, the challenges were the fact that this subject is a niche topic, suitable for gender studies, because we have to do only with men who made active duties. In Sebeș, I think, I was with Manuela in team doing the interviews, and I've noticed that, okay, Manuela just made the interviews about the communist period, but I think when you have to talk about the military experience, you should have some knowledge about the military technique, because I've had interviews with former tankers, with former infantrymen, I've asked about the weapons, about how I asked them to describe me the tanks, what were they thinking about this technique, and in order to do a proper dialogue, you have to know the military terms or the military technique. One thing I have noticed, and this is not specific to Roma ethnics, is that military service undergoes a reinterpretation, because the men have the tendency to repeat these events of their military service, and they have the tendency to present them as a positive experience, and lots of the interviews told me that this was a real school of life for them. School of life is forced life school. It's a forced translation, but this is how they told me. They were talking about their period in the army. Another challenge was the age. They are, as you know, the Roma have not such a big life expectancy, so they were in the 60s and the 70s, this group of interviewees which I have made interviews till now. At the beginning of my research, I was trying to get to the Roma veterans of World War II to try to get their stories, but we haven't found
just one.
So I could not do that, and I've just focused on this research about the communist period. This is about the perception of the compulsory military service in their perspective. From what I've talked with them, and from what I've seen in the law about military service, the military service in Romania was presented in the communist period as a honorable duty, and by the interviews was seen as a period of ripening, a maturization period. And especially for the Roma ethnics, which were not used to, I don't know, to socialize with everybody, with Romanian or German or Hungarian ethnics. This was a period of intense socialization, because they had to stay together, sleep together, eat together, and do everything together. And a period of hardships. From what I speak with my own, I will do that in the future. In the summer, I will make interviews with Romanian and Hungarian ethnics about this perception. But from what I speak with lots of people about this period, this is seen. If they are talking about the period, is it's not such a good period because it's their hardship in the army. You have to do training, you have to be polite with everybody, you have to do things you are not wanting to do. And only after some period of time passes up, after this military service, this period is analyzed and seen as a positive time, or as they are associated with positive memories. And as I've said already, for most of the Roma, this was the first time when they were outside of their communities and away from their families. And an interesting thing is that is the fact that some of them used the legal framework in order to avoid conscription. This was possible only after the decree and the law of 1972. We are getting there now. I wanted to see how this legislation affected the military service of the Roma in the communist period. So I went to the laws, and the first law about the military service is the decree number 468 from 30 December 1957. Which in the Article 1 states that military service is compulsory for all the citizens. They were not seen as ethnics or not, they were just citizens, simple citizens, and is seen as a military, as a honorable duty, just as they say, they said to me in the interviews. So this has a legal based, this is a legal based term. And most important, military law of 1972, and this is about this is very interesting how the rulers see the way in which the military service had to be done. Even with the defense of the motherland goes back to the Soviet laws of the Second World War, in calling Russia motherland. This Romania was seen as a, so this is seen a, too as a motherland, and everybody was had to defend the revolutionary conquest of the working people of Romania, and this was a sacred duty, again, honorable duty, sacred duty of every citizen, male, female, regardless of nationality. The ways in which the Roma ethnics avoided military service came to me when I tried to do some interviews in my grandparents' village, and I've managed only to get one interview with a man who did his military service, because everybody else used this article to evade military service, to avoid military service. So this is Article 49, which stipulates, you can see, the hardships based on which they were not supposed to be drafted, to be recruited in military service. And the biggest part of them used the last one, if the recruit is married and has at least two children under the age of 7 years, at the age of 20 years, which was the age when they were recruited. So especially Roma ethnics were in this situation, to have at the age of 20 years to have already have two minors and two children. So when I talked to Manuela about the fact that I wanted to have some documents about this, about the situation of the Roma ethnic group and their experience in the army, Manuela mentioned that she saw something about this in a report, in this study, and she highlighted me the passages which was very likely with very near as the fragments that I took from their from their stories, oral stories from the oral interviews. And again, it was mentioned that there were hardship with them because they were illiterate and was okay. And another aspect which has a parallel with the legal framework, is the aspect that they have already at the age of 20, they already have 3 to 4 children up to 4 years of age. Their wives are not employed, and due to this harsh situation of them, they were not to be drafted, and they are evading, with this they are evading the military service. So this was it. And in conclusion, I can say that in general, the military period is seen as a good time by them, a time in which they have access to things that they don't have at home, such like current water or plumbing or new clothing. Some of the interviews that I've made in Sebeș or even in my grandparents' village, people were very poor, so they had this positive perception of their time in the army as good times due to this fact. They had hot meal, good meals. Although the Romanian who did their military service say that in the army the food was not that good. But the Roma ethnic said, all of them almost said that it was a good time, due especially to these facts.
Okay. Questions?
How many interviews have you taken?
Well, personally I've took something like 10 to 20, but I've used some, I will use some part of the interviews made by my colleagues.
This is also included in...
Yes, I've said that it is included in the interview guide.
Nick?
If you remember the story with Mr. Anton from Pratei, the Kadra guy, the Master Kadra.
Yeah. Master Kadra.
He went twice in the army. First, he was recruited as usually, as compulsory, you had to go into the army to join the army. The second time, he went to National Guards, and he became, again, a full recruit in the army for another period. First time was 2 years, and the second time was about 1 year.
Okay, the thing is that after you have been, you've made your time in the army, you are you have to go back in the small periods of time in order to do your work. I don't know what's the term, concentration. Concentration. You have to mobilization. Yes. And two or three of the interviewees mentioned me. They were concentrated in the when there was some problems when there were problems in Czechoslovakia in 68. And.
Do they mention specifically that it was in 1968?
Yes. One thing I wanted to say is that these are part of the transcription because I am working on them for another presentation and I want to make a volume about the experience of the Roma in the army due to the fact that we haven't any kind of this.
We don't have any testimonies of experience in the communist army either. I mean, it's not that it's just not about the Roma.
So I have no background research about this.
Mr. Mihai from Mogus, who was second sergeant in the army, and he served as the he was second sergeant, and he was part of MIAI internal military.
Ah well, we have figures that.
They were everywhere. So we have Roma ethnics in the Securitate units.
Yes.
I've had an interview with one of my uncles, and he said he was a sergeant, major sergeant, and he had two Roma soldiers in subordinated to him in his platoon. We've had tankers, infantry, all kind of military service.
Sofiya?
Bulgarian case was mentioned, and I think it's very particular from the actually Evgenia Ivanova and Belcho Krstev. They have a book published on this, and Belcho Krstev has recently defended his PhD in functional in Bulgaria on the issue of Roma in the army in all historical periods of the Bulgarian state. It's very interesting, and what it says actually how the state policies towards the Roma as a citizens reflects the attitude of the states towards them in placing them within the army. Yeah. So in the modern time, after the independence of 19th century, until the Second World War, including the Second World War, Roma are as all other citizens. So if they cover certain criteria, they should go with the army. And many Roma were actually part of the army, they have medals and so on. In socialist period, because there are other ethnic elements, many of them Muslims, and because the significant ethnic and political other to the Bulgarian state was the neighboring Turkey, the Roma were sent to the so-called labor army units. So they were not with guns, but they were building railways and so on. And it was the Roma and the Turkish population. And actually, this is a form of segregation within the army, which shows also the attitude and the policy of the Bulgarian state towards the Roma and the Turkish minority. And it's actually a big shift. So for me, it's interesting that in the Romanian case, it was they were just part of the mainstream, so to say, units. Yeah?
About the subject, the Romanian period of the experience of the common Romanian recruit was divided into periods, the first cycle and the second cycle, and very similar with the Bulgarian experience, in the second cycle they were sent to works, different works.
Yes.
To Dunăre, Marea Neagră
channel,
to and to collect crops from
harvesting,
yes, to harvesting, to they were making roads, they were used just like that, but together with the Romanian and other ethnics, everybody was doing that. That no difference between the ethnic groups.
Yes, and also I think there is one research in Serbia by Adrian Boda, which he published something about the Roma in the army there. So maybe it would be useful if you read some study.
Is this book published?
Yes, I can send it to you, but it's in Bulgarian. But if you know some Russian, maybe it will help. And I'm really curious if the experience of the Roma will appear in any way specific compared to the others. So, but you say that you haven't.
Well, in this, from what I've seen till now, it is very the same thing for the Roma ethnics as for Romanian and Hungarian and German ethnic. Yeah.
Gabi?
Relating to what you said, I just knew the case from Hungary and the classic book of Michael Stewart, and it's somehow another experience of a community in the 1980s, I think he just had his PhD at London School of Economics in 1984, something like this. And the way he experienced his life with the community for one year and a half, all this gradual involvement was perceived by the gypsies in kind of a ironically or something, because for example they were like the people who were cleaning the streets in Budapest, and another example of the authorities, I don't know, once a year they came in the ghetto or something, and they said that, oh, we just brought some sweets for the children. But it was like a kind of a dust for cleaning their houses and their rooms, and they perceived this like, okay,
the state, the Hungarians come to show us how to live. There was kind of like this, and they accepted, okay, but yeah, they said, I'm not having a bath because this means it's like I'm staying in my own dirt. That was his explanation, or her explanation. I'm not sure if it was a male or a female. And that's why, I mean, it's an interesting topic, but I don't know if it is a study in Hungary about this, but it's kind of different how a gypsy community perceives this involvement in the Gadjo world, because this is the Gadjo world, and this gratitude that they have a hot meal, that means that at home they were somehow unsatisfied. And this in this community they were totally satisfied, for example, in Hungary. And that's why it just raised me some why this is happening there. And
I have only one or two interviews which said that it was better at home from this from the meal point of view, from what were they eating at home, mm-hmm. and 80% of them said told me that it was good food in the army,
but
good food, and good clothing and.
Also, for example, all interviews in regards to the army were mainly made in villages from different parts of the country, whereas the community you're talking about was near the main town, which meant they had more economic possibilities in order to sustain a decent lifestyle. So I think we should also take this into consideration.
Where Mike Stewart had his paper was really.
Yes, I know, because I am familiar with the book. I more or less read it, but he also claims at the beginning of the book that the gypsies living there were able to make a decent living. Also, those gypsies were mainly working in factories at one point.
Yes, of course.
And they were trying, in regards to Manuela's idea of integration and stuff like that, some of them were trying to get out of the third category, because that's what the community was called, in order to get apartment buildings and so on. So you can't generalize, really.
Yeah, I
also have some comment, because I also know the book in detail. So
I was just wanting to answer with this gadget.
Yes.
That was my
actually, most of the anthropological theories are based on the Roma versus non-Roma, and how Roma world is created versus the non-Roma. But I think the cases with the army show more similarities with the non-Roma experience than oppositions. Yes, of course, we're against their depending on. I come from one region of Bulgaria that is against others, dialectically and culturally, and so on, it's a seaside and so on. But I think actually these researchers, and particularly with the army, because I know the Bulgarian case, show how much actually Roma were part of the nation, nation of citizens, or even ethnic nations, than being from. So the layers of identity are really, we have to be aware of all the layers of identity and not stress only on the Roma, non-Roma opposition, which of course exists. And I think this is some general remark that has to be made when we speak about the time of the gypsies also.
I'm afraid we have to stop here if we want to move to the next speaker.
I don't have much time. So, let's move from here. This topic, it's supposed to be a bit more theoretical, and it is haunting me since the beginning of the project. When I first thought we're gonna do oral history interviews with Roma people, I was thinking, well, this is the moment we'll find different time framework, different way of describing or using the space or distance, so on, which in fact it was not the case. So there are a lot of questions, and it's not specific to the Roma population. I mean, what I'm going to talk about, it's something which is relevant, I think, to all oral history research, but it's a study case with the Roma oral history narratives, just because we have this great material and the stories are amazing. How is it visible? How can we find time, and how can we identify places just looking at oral history narratives? Is our way of thinking of time as chronological, starting from point A, ending to point B, and our training as historians or whatever, anthropologists, but anyway, scholars, is determining our way of perceiving and understanding time, and how is this reflected in oral history narratives? For example, our guide is so historical constructed. It starts with childhood and it ends with how is your life today? Surprise, surprise. but fortunately, we have anthropologists, ethnographers, and sociologists in the team, and then each chronological period was split into very many questions that add much juice to the guide itself. What is the point of time and space? And you would have some other question, I don't know. Is the point which, I mean, this discussion about narrative versus the truth, historical truth, was very much developed in the 70s, and it almost started with some big names in the 71, 73, and 75. There are three successive books in which historians, I don't know, it's not really a historian, but anyway, his contribution with his meta-narrative had a major impact on the way history, or historiography rather, was understood and dealt with. So what is the point? The point is that for traditionally, space and time in history were something fixed. We would have periodizations, and that was, and after communicating with the historians from other national backgrounds, I discovered that, surprise, surprise, this periodization is not so fixed as I was thinking to be. What is modern time? What is pre-medieval? How do we call those periods? But these all were true. We were sure that this was the way. And that's linear. While all this narration and story brought other issue. If the story matters, then where is the truth? Is there any way of dealing with both? I don't know, it says it's almost impossible, because history and fiction are pretty much, they have the same structure, they use the same tropes, there. Paul Vane says, try to mix them together. it is comprehensible, and it has a plot, it has an intrigue, but it is a narration. While Michel de Certeau speaks about the true content in the form of a narration. So there is something true, but how can we get there? And stuff gets more complicated when we speak about oral histories. So this is about rhythm. It's something fixed. And in order to understand and deal with this, I think it's very useful the time organization made by Fernand Braudel, who is speaking about a long durée, a long span, conjecture, and event. And my favorite historian, of course, has a very smart article in which he tries to explain how this works in oral history. And I think it's when we are looking at our interviews, this might give some understanding. Now, it's not very clear, but at least we have some understanding. And it's about the difference between truth and meaning. And Portelli speaks about two axes of time. One is horizontal, which means succession in time, which is split by events, and the other one is vertical, and he calls this levels and modes. Written historiography was just horizontal. We speak about history, succession of events, long durée. It doesn't matter if it is about phenomenon or succession of events. We need cause and we need consequences. While oral history brings something else, and he makes a very interesting comparison to the sun. So we have an horizontal line and a vertical line. And these vertical lines are the different way people speak about the same event. And that's about the meaning people assign to their own events in life. And then, starting from here, Portelli speaks about possibility of constructing other parallel chronological axes, which are not those belonging to the dominant narrative, but which is much more relevant to the lived history by a certain community, by families, by individuals, and it's definitely much more applied. It has a special meaning and significance within the society. He is strongly relating this time and the vertical strata, the time, institutional time, collective time, and personal time to three kind of spaces. We have institutional, the nation state and the world, and then collective time, it's related to town, neighborhood, and workplace, and personal, which is home. So these are specific places in which the narrative, that are encompassed in the narratives. And I will try to use some example in order to speak about this aspect. As I started to speak about in the first comments of this morning, there was this institutional history, or the history of the institution and the legislation that was imposed by the communist regime. And there were two which had a special impact on Roma life. That was the Decree 153 and specific policies, again, relating to gold, possession of gold. It was not just gold, it was gems and foreign currency. The legislation was launched in 1946, and it was increasingly became much more abusive until this one was the last one in 1978. Regarding the precious metals and gems. Basically, in the beginning, everyone in the country had to report all gold possession. That was the first part of the legislation, and then they had to submit everything they had to the national bank. There was a few exceptions, which were personal jewelry. So if you had earring, you were able to keep it, but not the money. What was the problem, in fact? The problem was that many Roma communities, especially the Căldărari, the Gabori, in the south, the Lăieți or Lăieși, which are Căldărari as well, invested the entire fortune in gold coins. The gold coins, and we have a very nice and interesting story, and I will focus on this one. which we found in this is a very interesting information about how this interview was conducted. We were in Shinyan, in the southern part of Romania. We were conducting an interview with a Holocaust survivor who was brought to the place of the interview by his nephew. And surprise, the nephew had an amazing story, and this is the story of the nephew. And the nephew said the story of how you can imagine there is no reference to the time. We don't know when this happens. I mean, nothing. But it's not difficult to find when it happens after I'm gonna tell you what the story is about. So the story goes like this. He and his brother and his father are on the street, and they are stopped by the militia, by the police, and they are arrested because allegedly they had too much gas in the tank of the car, which was suspicious, as they would go and sell stuff around the country, which was kind of illegal. Not really illegal, but kind of illegal. And they took them to the police station, and this was a bad guy, a bad militiaman. Another guy comes next day, which is a better person in the narrative. it's a better policeman. And they start a kind of negotiation. You know, if you don't give us what we want, it will be worse when the bad guy will come. And what do we want? 3 gold coins. Because there were 3. The sister who had a necklace with 3 coins was waiting outside. The father calls the girls in, takes the necklace and throws it on the table of the militia. Everybody goes crazy. No, take it, take it, take it. And I didn't understand at the moment what was this discussion about. And the pressure, policeman kept telling him to take the necklace and just to give them the coins. Why was this the case? Because the law in 78 forbid the police to confiscate any jewelry, but they were allowed to confiscate coins. So if the coins were on a necklace, the policemen would make themselves trespassing of the law. And this is the only mentioning that happens in the law in 78. So definitely this event, without making references to the time span, is sometime after 1978. But what is very interesting is that this story, though very particular, it's kind of convey overall perspective on the communist regime that was abusive regarding the possession of gold by the Roma. So it's not just a story. In different way, we found different particular stories about how what happened with the gold. But this is very, very, and it was very passionately explained to us how it happened. And And the last part of this interview brings us to another level of discussion: the relevance of the written versus oral testimonies. And so did my father, says our interviewee. He took the knife, cut the coins and gave them. And then they have done the report that they have found the coins at our porch. So in the report of how the coins entered, were confiscated, the coins were just there at the porch of this people's house. And so my point is oral history sometimes, though it's subjective, sometimes help us to understand how the written documents are written. So there are many other stories about time that could be discussed. And we can identify and see time without explicitly being mentioned. There are situations in which the memory of the interview is very precise and they make precise references. So it was in 77, or it was the next year my youngest son was born, or this kind of precise references. But otherwise, you just have to go through the entire story to see here and there how the time is constructing. This gives a very, and see how the institutional level of time, you know, the law was published in 1978, impacted on the time of the story. Another similar situation is with this decree in 1970. This decree is everywhere. In most of the oral history narrative, people make references to this decree without mentioning it sometimes, often mentioning the number 153. I don't know if in any of our interviews the year was mentioned, I don't think so. But what is common with other oral history narrative of the non-Roma is that everyone knew the communist regime would forcibly bring you to work if you wouldn't have. So this is the law that was implemented in 1970, but again, the general perception of the entire communist during the entire communist period is that you had to work, but apparently you had to work only after 1970, according to the law. So this is a different meaning time has in this oral history narrative. I have a lot of. What about space? What is interesting in the spaces in how spaces is represented is that there are two different. Everything is about proximity, and our professor Dora Dussal speaks about this proximity, how close in time and space the subjects are and the places are. In oral history narratives, there are descriptions of places and of distances. Some places are accessible, some places are not. What is very interesting is that I have not seen a description of their own space as marginal, or even though they lived in very bad condition, they would speak about the fact that they lived in bad condition and it was difficult, but not that it's peripheral, not that it's at the outskirts of the town. It was a given. This is where we are. While on the other hand, when we want to communities with better social status, they emphasize that they had Versace tiles on the floor, and that the entire community is at the center of the community, the space of the village, the center is populated by themselves. So this is something that it's different. So the meaning of the space is different in according to a narration coming from different Roma groups. So yeah, this is just a lot of thinking I'm going through now with this time and how it is constructing, and probably I hope I'll get some feedback, good feedback from you to clarify stuff. Thank you. We don't have much time for questions.
So space.
So space.
So about space, and if you think about these different communities that are spread all over the country, how do you propose to deal with that in the
narrative you are constructing?
I have no idea. I think I will try to avoid generalizations or to speak in general there. This is the way. There are very particular way in dealing with space. And anyway, I think after doing these interviews with the entire team, I am more and more convinced of the importance of individual stories. So it's very difficult to make generalization, and if possible, we can do it only at the level of specific communities. For example, the Gabor in Crăciunești. Yes, we can speak about something that is common for the Gabor in Crăciunești, or the Rudari in Oltenia, or the people in Măguri. Măguri is a very nice village where Ionela almost got married. So this is a village which is inhabited mostly by Roma people. Yes, so this is the only way I think we can deal with that, but not speaking in general about Roma in Romania, which every time I'm using this very... how do we call this? I have something is missing in my head. a conventional way of speaking about the Roma, it's not very appropriate. I mean, there are Roma communities, and even within the communities are huge differences, and the stories that are amazingly different. Yeah.
I also wanted to ask you about this degree you mentioned from the 1970s, because in Bulgaria since the 50s, work is obligatory, so every single citizen has to have work, and then Roma were found jobs, so to say. And in scholarship in post-communism, it's written that this is a kind of oppression of the regime, so you're forced to work to settle and so on. But in the oral stories of the Roma, both settlement and finding a work is a great thing, because for many of them, especially the women, this was the first time to get cash and to decide what to do with it. So it's. For me, it's interesting. Is it from the 70s or it's from the earlier periods?
No, it's from the 70s. This way, it was earlier, but it was not incriminated. Uh-huh. In the 70s, you would be put in prison if not having a work.
And how do they assess their... Because they say, yeah, we just go to job and then we can do petit trade and everything, so they were able to combine. So for them, it's like a double benefit, so to say, to have a salary and to be able to do your stuff. How did you come?
It's again different in different communities.
Yes.
For the Gabor, they succeeded to have authorization from the state and to continue to do their traditional coppersmith work. There are many abuses by the authorities. We have a story of a gentleman who spoke about one of experience of him. He and his brother went in Bucharest to sell copper vessels. I forgot again the name for that. Big, huge, no? And they were caught by the police. They showed the authorization they used to have, and the policeman took the authorization and said, "You don't have it anymore. You go in prison." So they had to stay in prison for several days, and their father in Crăciunești went to the local council, took a duplicate of the authorization, went in Bucharest, and showed that they in fact had an authorization. So this abusive behavior from the... But it was not generalized. Even in Crăciunești, where the Gabor live, and most of them had this authorization, as I said, even women had authorization sometimes. Even there we could find nostalgia and positive view of the communist regime, because it was much order.
And we have this very interesting interview context in which we were in the house of a gentleman and his brother, and it was good at the time, and the brother said, come on, it was good, we couldn't go make any trade abroad. Yes, right, you're right. And then he kept saying, but we had food, there was water, and the brother is like, but you know, the police was after us, and we were put in jail, and so on. So these are, and this interview, double interview, it's very relevant for the way the communist regime is perceived, and it's not specific for the Roma. It's,
yes, for the
it's in general. On the other hand, we have the story of the stories in the communities in Sebeș. It's a small town not far from Cluj. Most people used to work in local factories. And they live now on the pension they have, so they are very nostalgic about those period, especially because their children and grandchildren don't have any opportunities anymore. So it's, again, it depends on the community. Yeah, I think we have to stop here.